Hallelujah. 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 Yabarak. You may be seated, YisraYah. What a great and the most honorable privilege that Yah grants unto man, that he may be the conduit, that he may express unto his people the significance of his power, his beauty, his strength, that we may, Yada, we may know him with an expression of rejoicing. It is an expression of rejoicing. When one truly Yada knows, he understands the principles, the beauty, the character of Almighty Yah, and it causes his love to rejoice greatly. And that is one of the things that must be prominent among YisraYah in order for us to enjoy the delight of Almighty Yah, his promises, that we may delight in all that he grants unto us. We're in a time whereby we see the very mindset that is, it is diametrically opposed unto Yah. There are not many that truly love Yah. He gave YisraYah the Shabbats, the Shabbaton, to assure them of his brits, his covenant. His brit is his alliance, his allegiance, his treaty that he has signed with the people. And to signify that, he says unto us, I want you to zachar hamshabbat, to remember the Shabbat. And he says, I want you to shema, I want you to guard it, to observe it. I want you to keep it, guard it, to observe it. I want you to do that in a chadosh. I want it to be set apart from every day. There is no laborious activities. You don't plan any events. You don't participate in one thing that damns the covenant that I have erected with you. And this is a mindset today that really doesn't give a damn about Yah. Everything supersedes what Yah says. Everything. I don't give a damn what it is. It supersedes what Yah says. This shows the very strength, the nature of a rebellious harlotry spirit. It is the spirit of a whore that she sells herself in the temples, in the houses of prostitution. She sells her flesh. She satisfies the element of her most twisted, thwarted desire, and that is the desire of the flesh. And we cannot hold back, YisraYah. It is one thing that Yah must have messengers of strength. We can't be shallow. We can't be so easily offended by the smallest little infraction. This is a damn juvenile nature. Their emotions are easily infringed upon. Well, you can't scar me that way. I don't give a damn, and I say it that way. What this world thinks of me, what it says, its attitude, I don't give a damn. Now, how about that? Now, if that's too tender for your ears, I would advise you to find someone like Brokeback Benny Hinn. Of course, our main man down there in the state of Georgia, Mr. Eddie Long, he said that, quote, this battle I will fight, unquote. Undoubtedly, he surrendered probably to the tune of $2 or $3 million apiece, because he is a rapist, pedophile of a damn twisted beast. We don't want men that are honest with integrity and tell us the truth. We don't want nobody to confront our damn wicked ways, what we don't want. We love men like that. And of course, he will wear the $10,000-$12,000 watches and the $40,000-$50,000 diamond rings and drive his $160,000 Bentley, his Rolls Royce, and then he will fly in Lear jets with his buddies to traverse, to display his own wickedness. And this is what the people love, because they don't give a damn about Yah. And that's the truth. If we love him, we keep, we guard, we shema his mitzvah. I don't give a damn who it is, young or old. It makes no difference at all. You don't compromise, or you don't join partners with a thief. And those that are extortioners against Almighty Yah, what is Yahshua coming for? Is he coming for a trotting down, dirty, unclean, Khala, a bride, an Ish, Shah, and Chut, but above all, a Bechula, one that is pure, one's mind that is set apart from the wickedness of the world? He's coming for a Khala, a Khala, a pure, and a clean, virtuous Bechula, one without the contaminations of the earth, one who is sharp and ready when they hear the sound of the shofar, that they have prepared themselves, they are made ready, and they are ready to go into the bride's, into the challah, the bridegroom's chamber. They're ready to enter in because they know that there shall be great delight. Hallelujah. So he's coming for this beautiful entity that is clean from the corruption of sin, chasra, that there's a willingness, a mind that transgresses the Torah of Almighty Yah. I had indicated that I wanted to begin a teaching on the Gideon, but I want to impose something differently this Shabbat. And then I will begin that teaching on next Shabbat. It will be a tremendous blessing to us all. It is vital that we, as men of Yah, that we have to go beyond our physical limitations. When we want to rest, the times we must labor in the Torah, in the Gitzon, we must become hewers. We must allow the Torah to begin to hew in this stony thing we call Elev. It begins to eradicate and cut off and abandon everything that is of the nature of the flesh, and that we will become perfect, complete in the sight of Almighty Yah. We have played a game too long. It has not produced anything at all. You know, this is something that has always amazed me. That if I see something that is not, I'm going in a direction, I'm doing things that are not working for my advantage in Almighty Yah Yahshua, then something is wrong if you continue that route, that derech. Something is drastically twisted in your damn foolish, this unjustice mind, in your mind, Yisrael. Something is wrong there. And that's the truth. He's coming for a jewel, Yahshua. He's not coming for a stinking, slutty thing. And we have played the role of a harlot, have we not? We have been an adulterous whore, a dirty Jezebel. Now there are those that when I use the word whore, or many think that I'm addressing the daughters of Tizayon, as that is not the case. I use it in the context of what the Khatve says. And I will not alter that for some kind of appeasing to the mind of this, or the minds of this adulterous generation. And then when you do that, they still forsake you. And that's the truth. Hallelujah. There are many that say, I love you, man. And when they say that, I say, ouch. You show me your love by your quietness and the beauty of your ruach. I have something for us today to cause us to examine our heart. I want to read a little of an article that I mentioned the other day in the dining hall. It is a direct assault upon the daughters of Tizayon and also the people of the diaspora, those of the middle passage. And the statement, it was made by this supposedly intellectual. His name is Satoshi Kanazawa. Satoshi Kanazawa. He's a Japanese intellectual. And it says that, quote, he caused a firestorm after claiming that black women, and of course your daughters are not black women. You are the daughters of Raah Dawid YisraYah. Hallelujah. So he makes a statement, and he calls a firestorm this politically correct society that is based upon false principles, corrupt of such hypocrisy. It is always trying to appease flesh, and yet it does it with the subtlety of witchcraft to deceive the minds of the people. That's why today that most women today that they, and I love your daughters that is Zion. That's why y'all never intended for precious daughters. He intended, can I share this before I go a little farther? He intended for them to understand the power of the Ruach, the hand, Yah's order of his established order and his principles, his foundational strengths and truths that will generate a tremendous beauty and power, not just in the Ish, but in the Isha as well. Hashatan has done a marvelous job by establishing what we call stars, movie stars. And what a star does it illuminate light? That's what it's for. That is what the celestial order is for, is to illuminate light. And so they have set these twisted Jezanites, these Jezebels that are the freaks of the world. They are wicked, twisted, and dirty Jezebels to eliminate what we call the false, presumptuous light of Hashatan. Did not Yeshua the Melech, the Melechim, behold him falling from Hashemayim as light? Is he not the day star of the earth today? Sure he is. So he sets in power and order this kind of deceptive mandate to trick the minds of the masses. There's only one mind that has battled that wicked mind, that has overcome greatly with power, with might, and that is the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach, the only mind. The natural mind cannot battle the onslaughts of hell. You cannot tackle that. It takes a mind that is much more superior. And so he constantly operates in the form of light. Of light. You go to the big cities, there are lights, and everyone seems happy because they're drunk, they're wicked, and they're doing every kind of thing it is. Sure it is. And yet they are miserable because they have not the wisdom of Yah. He is not coming for whore cuts in the streets of corruption. He's coming for a daughter, a bath, a Tizayon, and her beauty is not expressed the way this crazy fool here express his insult against even my Ishua, hallelujah, as his descriptive parallel or his writings concerning the women of color. This is what he says. I want to read it quickly. There's a few verses here. It's in the Psychology Today. He sparked this firestorm by his latest posting. It was entitled, A Look at the Hard Truth About Human Nature. He says, in it, the evolutionary psychologist of London School of Economics, he argues that black women are less physically attractive than other women. The article was quickly removed from the posting site, but not before screenshots from BuzzFeed and other experts had retrieved the article. And this is what he says, quote, what accounts for the markedly low average level of physical attractiveness among black women? Black women are on the average much heavier than non-black women. May I inject, he certainly hasn't gone to Walmart lately, has he? Or the Penny Pinchers store. all right. He hasn't gone to the dollar mart. And I need to bring him down here to the flea market on Yom Rishon. How about that? All right then. Quote, the mean body mass index, BMI, at wave 3 is 28.5 among black women and 26.1 among non-black women. Black and non-black men do not differ in BMI, 27.0 versus 26.9. However, this is not the reason that black women are less physically attractive than non-black women. Black women have lower average level of physical attractiveness, not of BMI, body mass index. Nor can the race differ in intellectual or intelligentsia and the positive association between intellectual and physical attractiveness accounts for the race differences in physical attraction among black women. Black women are still less physical attractive than non-black women, net of body mass index and intelligence. Quote, net of intelligence, black men are significantly more attractive than non-black men, unquote. Now, I wanted to read that not only because of the implications of what this fool indicated, but to express unto Yisrael the beauty, the character of Yah, what expresses the very beauty of Almighty Yah in his people. You understand, we have put on this kind of attractiveness or non-attractiveness, but we have not put on the beauty of Almighty Yah. And so in the presence of our Abba, we look like an unattractive, imperious, sluttish whore. It's only by the mercies of his reasons, his hasids, his tav, his kindness, that he cares for his people. And because our minds are so thwarted and twisted, we don't even know how to even appreciate the unmerited favor that he has granted unto us. And he gives us a descriptive characteristic that he demands of his bride-to-be, this beautiful entity that shall be the crown or the diadem of his crown. We as a nation of people, Yisrael, we must adhere to that. And he gives us one of the most profound expressions of that in the body of the Ish, the Chala, the Beth Ula, the Ish-sha, the woman, is what he gives us that in. I want to open our ears and our understanding to a simple truth today. This is simple. It has no ramifications of anything that is profound, but yet it is profound. For we have missed the mark of his beauty. We have missed the mark of his strength, the mark of his beauty. We have missed it drastically. And the world has given the daughters of Tizayun a false beauty, and it's not the beauty of Yah. It stinks, and they stink. It's filthy, and they are filthy. I will read what the book says. You have a problem, you take it up with the Most High. I want to read quickly from the book of Yeshaya. I will, my friend, and I will take my time today. Hallelujah. It makes no difference whether you like me or not. You're not going to like me whether I tell you the truth and whether I tell you a lie. Then you will say he's a liar. At least you can say he makes me angry. But he tells the truth. He comes out of the book. It is nothing that is mystical. He's reading the way it is writ in the book. Yah speaks to his people here in Yeshaya chapter 62, one verse I want to read. In verse, hallelujah, 5. He says here, he says, for as a young, as a bachor, a young man of strength, as a young man marries, or Baal, we know that is what Zeriah called Avraham Baal, because she was his espoused one. So as a young man marries a Bethula, a virgin, a Kala, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as the bridegroom, as the Bachor, as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your Abba rejoice over you. Yeshaya 62 and verse 5. As Yeshua rejoices over his bride, and this Kala, the bride of Yeshua, she must have the beauty of an expression that even the nations of the earth marvel at her. There has to be a difference between the Bath and the sons of Tizayon, of Yerushalayim, the true worshippers of Yah, that's worship him in Ruach and in Imat truth, than those that are the heathens or the Goem, the nations, that have no kind of relationship to him at all. Now, I'm going to be specific today, Yisrael, and I'm going to deal with the very things of our own bosom that we may understand. We have not had the teachers to teach us. The men have left the post to guard and to watch the city. And the daughters of Tizayon, they are running rampantly in all kinds of perverse wickedness. And that is why women today, they disregard the rush, they disregard the head, they disregard the man. And it is to their own peril. As long as it is shalom to live with any man, you abide under the auspice of that order. If it's shalom. And if it's not, then you are free to receive a writing. And he must give her a writing, a bill of divorcement. And that's what Yah is going to do with those that are not his faithful ones. I want to begin here in the book of Mishlei. Very descriptive here. Book of Proverbs, chapter 18, verse 22. A man of great wisdom, a man that had concubines. So it was not the physical attraction or the physical sensualization, not her genitalia, that caused him to delight. That this is what the world has taught us today. This is what it has taught the women today. But that was not what he was looking for. That's not what Yeshua is coming for. He is not coming for that, Yisrael. He's coming for a beauty that is beyond that. So this man that had concubine, and every woman would have bowed at his feet to intrigue him to fulfill his wildest thoughts of imagination. It was not what he was looking for. It was not. So he asks the question. He speaks profoundly here in Proverbs 18, 22. He says, I want to know whoso that can, Massa, who can secure, who can find, who is the one that can meet in this hour or even encounter. That is what Massa is. Where in our everyday life, a young man he encounters, he meets, he falls upon, it is wonderfully and important that we understand how to define Yah's speech. And not the speech of this Babylonian exercising of speech that we have become so accustomed to. That we think we understand what it defines. But that is not what Yah is saying. Who can? Whosoever. The one that can find. He can obtain. Or that one appears before him. An Isha, a wife. Who can find that today? Who can find a wife today? I will get into the details and the beauty of a beautiful wife and the strength of a man as well. The man shall not go unscathed, no more than the daughter of Zion. But in her expression, there's a filth there that is much more pronounced, because she is the one that transgressed and she was deceived, and it brought this confusion into the earth or into this realm. It was not the man. You don't have to buy it, but it is still the truth, Yisrael. Whosoever finds, or the one that Massah that encounters or meet, you can't even meet this today. There are very few occasions where man can meet or encounter, or he attained, he meets a wife, an Isha. It says he finds a pleasant, a tub, a tal, a very pleasant, a beautiful thing. And not only that, but a wife is beneficial. That is what tav is. That is what tob or tav is. It is one that is beneficial and one that causes strength to multiply in one's life. So when a man finds that, that's what Yeshua is coming for. He is not coming for a slutty, worldly thing. He's coming for one that is beautiful and she set apart. And the chatzveh gives us a descriptive demeanor of her character, her mind, and it shows us a way of one that is diametrically opposed to the beauty of Almighty Yah. The world has messed the minds of the women up today. And so the daughters of Tizayon must be retrained. That's why the imma, the mothers, are going to be in trouble when they stand before Yah. They're going to be in trouble. I'm telling you that. Because we don't want to confront the things that are foul and things that are not right. Because, hell, we're not right. And because of that, we don't want to confront that which will expose our own damn wickedness. I want my sins to go before me. I want my weakness and my wickedness to appear before Yah. And so we set all subdue and quiet. I leave that alone. Hell no, I say it that way. I'm not going to leave it alone. And I don't give a damn if you don't like me either. It makes no difference at all. We're going to get down to the nitty gritty. Hallelujah. For the world has made the bath of Tizayon to look like fools. And Yah doesn't want that, daughters of Tizayon. Who can encounter, who can miss, where you going to meet a wife today? At the clubhouse? At the church house? I will, my friend. Hell, at the health spa? Where are you going to meet one today? So when a man miss, when he encounters a woman, when he meets an Isha, a wife, he finds a pleasant thing. She is a pleasant thing. That's what a wife is. She's a pleasant thing. She's an agreeable thing. And I will show us in the teaching on today. He finds something that is pleasant, that is well-favored of Almighty Yah. When a man finds a wife, it is just not any man that finds a wife. And that's the truth. He must possess certain characteristics and a beauty in order to find a wife. Either that so, or Yah is a liar and he cannot lie. He is immune from lying. So everyone thinks that she or he's a husband and she's a wife. Well, she's not a wife. Come on, the beasts of the fields lay in field with the bull. Hell, that doesn't make a wife because you can lay down. That doesn't make you a beautiful wife. Hell, that's not the constitution of a wife. It is the truth, and I would define it according to Chatveh. You're not fine. And when one has the fineness of Yah, they bring forth out the beauty of his Yahin, the wine, the delight, the refreshing wine of Yah. There's something you want to drink from that fountain. But when it's not that way, you don't want to drink from that filthy fountain. Man doesn't want to drink from that fountain because there is no pleasant coolness and resolve that comes from that fountain. When a man finds a wife, he finds a tough thing. And he puk, that is the promise of Yah, he puk. And he finds favor, he finds rason. He finds delight and pleasure and favor with Almighty Yah. He finds an acceptance. Yah says to the man, you accept it. Because in order for a man to find a wife, He must genuinely have a character in him that is of the nature of Yah. And scripture, the Khatve, will express that as I continue. So Rahman has found a wife. He does not allow his nature to generate or cause him to be moved from the Torah of Almighty Yah. And when a daughter of Tizayon, when she is a true daughter, when she is the beauty of the expression of Almighty Yah, she will be found by one that has the very mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. She will be found. He will be one that above all he fears Yah. He has a great reverence. He will not stand down from the principles of Yah for no one. He will not remove or allow the order of Yah to be resolved in his mind, his heart, for no damn woman. None whatsoever. And because of her beauty, he knows he has found a pleasant and a beautiful thing. Well, why today then? There are not many. Why? Because hell, no one teaches them. No one says to her, you're wrong. Sit down, young man. You're not even ready for a wife. You're not even prepared. Your mind is not even ready. Woman, you are silly as hell. You're not ready. You don't even know how to entertain a husband. And all of a sudden, within a few weeks, you meet, you're ready to marry. You're ready to go beyond that. It should not be so, Yisrael. Young man should labor, the young daughter of Tizayon, she should labor and present herself. The beauty of Yah is expressed from her bosom. And as he labors, as he waits, as Yahachob did, he has the ability to endure and to wait. But today, the women today, they think that it's because of the veracity of their sexual ability. Hell, that doesn't mean anything. Any man can get sex, woman. You are stupid as hell. Yes, I'm going to say it that way. You are a dumb, you're not even a bimbo to think that a man cannot. You see what the article said, that men that are black men, as it expressed, they're much more attractive than non-colored men. That's what it says. Hallelujah. So it's not an issue where the man of color can find someone to arouse his nature. That's not the issue. He's looking for a wife, for a pleasant thing, a jewel and a gem, one that has the beauty of the expression of the covenant of Yah in their bosom, and not the folly as the darkness of this world presents itself in light, has shone and presented this false image to the daughters of Tizayon. And that's why they are in pursuit. That's why they follow the very same ritual, the very same manner, and the very same way. You understand? When a man finds something that is beautiful, he has the patience to wait and to look, to observe, and to make sure that it is right. I advise any man, hell, you just don't hook up because you met up. You don't go that way. There must be a genuine expression in the bosom of the woman and the man. Whether there's a genuine desire for Almighty Yah, or is there a damn wicked false pretense for their own profiting and their own gain? I don't give a damn if you don't like me. If you don't like me because that's what's in you. You don't want me to say because that's what's in your nature. So when you hear me, you get upset. You will go to hell. That's not love. That's love. That's truth. We will see what Yah says. He speaks of this in Dibarim. He said, when a man finds a wife, he finds a tough thing. But look at what he says here in the book of Dibarim, Deuteronomy, chapter 24. It tells us the order of Yah. It says, when a man, Dibarim 24, verse 1, when a man takes, when he takes a wife, and he marries the woman when he becomes her Baal, that means he becomes the one that rules over her. I know what the world says. No one is going to rule over me. That is what the world has done to the women today, that there is no beauty in the woman today. She wants to be as audacious and bold as a man. She wants to stand up in his face. She wants to challenge every damn word he speaks. It's wrong, Yisrael. What a man Baal, when he marries a woman, when he becomes her head, her rush, her ruler, her prince, her charm, when he marries a woman, when he marries her, and it comes to pass, he finds no favor in the woman. Dibarim 24:1. And it comes to pass after some years of marriage, he finds no charm, he finds no elegance, he finds no beauty, he finds no beautiful romance in the woman. She is not precious anymore. That's what it says. When he finds that. When he finds that. What a man. It did not say when the man finds a wife. But a man marries a woman. There are many that have married women. And it came to pass in years. There was no charm in the woman. She was not beautiful. She was not precious. You're destroying our daughters. No, the world is destroying the bath that is on. It's caused you to remove from the place of beauty. You look just like the world. You act like the world. Well, I'm going to bring this home here. You might as well sit down and be quiet. Hallelujah. Well, he is brutalizing the daughters. No, the world is brutalizing the women. The world is raping the women. I saw a woman had on a pair of shoes and the heels were like that. You tell me the world, that's not stupid. You tell me these damn wicked faggots designed something like that. You think you're a fly? You are a fruitcake. That's not even healthy for you. That's not even wise. And you think that's a sign of beauty? It's a sign of a fool. You can't even hardly walk. That's not of your. Your beauty is not expressed that way. That's a sick of a freak for a woman to have on shoes that high. The other day with my in-show, I saw this woman. I stopped. I had to just look. And there was a taxi driver behind me blowing his horn. Bop, bop, bop. And I'm looking at this woman. I stop. I kind of pull over. And I look. Here she is, bigger than me. She got on heels like that. Like that, and I'm not lying. And her gut was hanging over like a pig. And I said, how is this woman walking? It's just bizarre. I would never do that. You would do the same thing. You may think you would not. You just don't understand the power of the spirit of the world. You would dress just like them. You act just like them. You can say what you want to. You do the same thing. When it comes to pass, he finds no chin, no favor, no beauty in his eyes because he has found some evra, some uncleanliness. What is the evra? The evra. She behaves improperly. She doesn't behave like a woman. When I was a young lad, the elderly women would say, behave yourself, girl. You act like a woman. Behave yourself, boy. You act the way a man acts. You act like some really feminine man. You act like a man. So when he finds some kind of uncleanliness, some kind of ifva, this unclean nature, she is improper. Her attitude is not right. Her spirit is not right. Her concept about marriage is not right. That's what ifva is. Her nakedness is exposed because she runs her damn mouth. She talks too damn much. And I will deal with that, what the cut face says. She thinks he's got to answer everything. That's not the beauty of a wife. That's the beauty. That's the wickedness of the world, what they present. So when he found this Eva, this uncleanness, he sees the more she talks, the more naked she exposes herself. That's how people are. The more they talk, the you see more about them. Well, it's them. No, Jezebel, it's you. Nobody likes me. You're not even likable. I don't blame them. Hell, I don't like you. Nobody wants to be around. Hell, I don't want to be around you. No, you look at yourself. We have the ability and the propensity to always think that it's someone else, don't we? That's why we're in the damn fix we're in. No, I'm not going to stop talking the way I talk. You can forget that. We're in the shape we're in, and I talk like this, and those that hear me, we're still in bad shape. I'm not going to stop talking like this. I will die talking like this. I will take my last breath talking like this. I'm not going to spare this wicked generation. We have not spared you. We have brought your shoe to open shame. We trample him on our damn dirty feet. Step on him. That's what we do. You can forget that one. Hallelujah. And so the man, he finds this erva, this improper, this behavior that is wrong. It is unclean in this woman. She's a naked thing because the more she talks, her actions, you can see how shallow, how unclean, how filthy, how wicked she is. It says, he sees that in her. It says, let the man write the woman a bill of divorcement. Keratuth. Leave the woman. Tell her, you go your way. Here's a bill of divorcement. Here's what you're entitled to. And you go. That's what Yah says. And that's the reason why, man. Because if you don't, you will never fulfill the command that Yah says. Don't give your strength unto the woman. Listen, Yisrael. It is not to belittle the daughters of Tizayon. It is to bring you up and to show you the strength of your beauty. You let the world rob you of. You let the world rob you and rape your mind. That's why you're not happy. That's why nothing is going to happen in, according to your will and your flesh. Hallelujah. He said, give her a bill of divorcement in her hand. And he says, I want you to shelach sin her out of his house. No, you send her out of your house. See, the world says, man, you leave the house. No, Yah says you send the woman out of your house. But the world in this nation says, no, man, you leave the house and give it to the woman. Many men today are suffering greatly because of that. Men that were genuine, men that were sincere, men are going through great affliction because this is an unjust system. But the Torah says, you send her out of your house. You put her out, you let her be gone, you give her a bill of divorcement, and you're free, man. That's what the Torah says. I don't give a damn what your emotions speak. Get how your feelings speak. I don't care what it speaks to you. This is what Yah says, who is right. Yah is right. Yah is right. I don't care what the attorney says. Yah is right. I don't care what the law of this land, when it defies Yah. Yah is right. He said, you send the woman out of your house. She doesn't want to abide in the place of the beauty of her wife, that she get all of the trimmings, expression of Yah. She got a covering. She has a rush. She has a head. She has all of the amenities of Yah. Something is wrong in that mind. And that's just the truth. You're belittling the daughters. No, I'm belittling the Jezebels, but not the pure daughters of Tizayon. No. No, those that walk in the light of Yah's truth. No. That's why you don't find, where will a man even matzah? Where will he even meet a wife? They're looking everywhere, are they not? Internet. Dating services, everything, trying to find a wife. You never find one that way. Unless she is in Yeshua HaMashiach, unless she's a pure daughter of Tizayon, you will never find a wife. You can search between here and Saudi Arabia. You can find all the different shades and the color of skins of women. You can find them that a skin is a rail and big as a house. But that doesn't constitute a wife at all, Yisrael. And the enemy has taken away this essential beauty of the daughters, that they have no understanding of their beauty and their value and their prestige, their beautiful pristine, their beauty of purity. They don't even understand. They're trading it all for a harlotry spirit, for a damn dirty naked spirit that shows their nakedness. It was one thing in my days that we could say to one, I see you, man, I can read you. I know what you're about, woman. Come on. You're not hiding anything today. And nobody wants to be honest. Although we were wicked and sinners, we were forthright with individuals and straight up and honest. No one wants that today. You see them acting like a fool? You don't want to confront that. In my days, come on, Zacchaeus, in your days, a boy was acting like a fool. You say, well, come on, man, what's up with that? Come on, don't do that. Don't go that way, man. Come on, man, hold up now. They didn't know how to handle that thing like that. Come on, man. And people had respect for that. You see, people say, okay, I'll handle that. I'll walk away from it. But today you can't say that. And don't think you can say that. You can't say that to one that say that they love. Yeah, because they know everything. And they don't know a damn thing. Hallelujah. So you can't teach nobody anything you don't know because you have no experience. So you don't know. So you must learn. You must learn, and you have not learned. It's amazing that men and women, every relationship they have in the world, it failed. No man even loved you. The hell, what do you think? I would think that if I'm a man, I am a man. I would somehow want to change my attitude, my spirit. Something went wrong, so let me alter my whole beauty. I would do that. Hell, no man love you, no woman love you. I would think I would alter that, man. Come on, woman. You're not as beautiful as you think. That's the truth. And that is not the tifra of Yah. The beauty of Yah is a quiet and a meek spirit. It's a spirit without contempt and fighting against the rush, the head. Can I move on? This is a sure sign when you want to find, if you find this concerning a man, then run away from this man. It says in the book of Proverbs, hallelujah. Mishali, Proverbs 24:30. Are we going to deal with what Yah says, all right? It says in Proverbs 24, verse 30, Shlomo said, I went by the field. I went by the sadeh. I went by the field, the cultivated field. As Yosef and I was in the garden the other day, I quoted this scripture. We were talking about this one chatzuv here. I said, Yosef, it's important that when they come by our garden, that they see that it's cultivated, no weeds, and everything is aligned properly. You will see that there is an attentiveness, and the man, the people have purpose here. I say, so get every weed, my friend. Let's get them. Go down the row, even though it looks cleaned, there are weeds there. You missed that one. You missed that one. It says here, he said, I went by the field. He said, I went by the field of a slothful, an asel, a lazy, trifless, lazy man. And by the vineyard of the man, Adam, or the Adam, void of bina. He was a man that his heart had no understanding of the wisdom of Yah. He said, I went by the man's vineyard. I went by his field. And that vineyard represents the man's character. It represents what he presents. You go by a man and you see this weedy attitude. There's nothing but thorns and thistles in the man's life. He's weak and he's shallow. You know that that man's heart is void of the wisdom of Almighty Yah. When you go by, I have gone in one's house. I recall this many years ago. The individual was here at one time. I went to his house and I watched his wife intrigue him like a damn boy. And when I saw that, I promised, yeah, I will never go back to that man's house, and I've never gone back to his house again. I've never walked across the doors of his house. As I could never do that. And I watched the way the wife intrigued him, the way she talked to him. I watched the way she presented, and she did not have any shame at all. I said, Yah, I will never go back in this man's house again. And I never went back in that man's house again to this day. And I will not go in his house again. And I never did, YisraYah. Oh, I know how we are, I don't operate like you. I operate in this Torah of Yah. I don't operate. When it's right to do, I will do it. I don't care what no one says. I don't care how they feel. I don't care how you feel toward me. So when you go by a man's vineyard, the man void of understanding, you will see he has no spiritual laws. There are no principles of Yah that he articulates. He is a silly man. He's a man that loves to love laughter. His house is all broken down. That is one reason that this place in Yisra'iyah, you're not going to. I don't want strangers to come in here and see that this house is not taken care of. This is our vineyard right here. You got all broken down cars and oil here and everything, all broken down gate. No, sir, no, ma'am, that will not be. I will never allow that. Not as long as I'm alive and I have strength in my vessels.
You come by a place, you can tell an asel, a man that is lazy and is thriftless. You go around his house, you look around his house, you see trash. Nothing is orderly. Nothing is in place. Everything is out of whack and everything is out of place. I wouldn't want my daughter with a man like that. Because that's that man's spirit. You go by his house, you go by his garden, you see weeds everywhere. The weeds are taller than the fruitful things. You began to elaborate with the man and his spiritual life. It is about small as an ant. Every kind of weed growing up out of him. I don't want no fellowship with a man like that. He said, I saw that. He said, and lo, it was all grown over with thorns. And not only that, but with nettles had covered the face thereof, and the stone wall there was broken down. The place of strength, the watchtower, it was broken down. He had no ability to watch. How could a man that cannot watch for his own nefesh, how's he going to watch for the nefesh of his Isha? How's he going to watch for the nefesh of his lutaf or his bina? How's he going to do that? How's he going to do that? So he went by this man's house. He saw that old stony heart that he had. It was all broken down. It was a heart that was not established in truth. It did not regard the Torah of Yah. He allowed every kind of thorn, every kind of thistle, everything came his way. He subjected himself to that instead of subjecting himself unto the Torah of Yah. And there are men that way, they're weak. They will not subject themselves unto Yah. There are men that don't even know Yah, never even heard of his name, but they have a strength, an innate power, ability to do what is right and to set order in their house right. They don't know nothing about Yah. Don't even serve a damn God. But yet they have the ability. There's something in them that this is right to do, and we're going to do it. No, we're not doing it any other way. This is it. You understand his house is in control. His house is in order. You don't go by his house and see old broken down doors in the wood. The doors collapsing and the windows all broken down and the grass that high and never mowed. Come on. You don't go by that man's house. You see his yard is taken care of. It's clean. His house looks nice. When he needs to paint the house, he paints the house. When we need to refresh ourselves in Yeshua, how much we refresh ourselves. You don't see old cars all parked out, old dogs running everywhere, dog dung all over the yard. You walk, you're scared to walk. You don't see that. It's same thing in the spiritual realm. Same thing. You don't see a man that has the spiritual delight of Yah in folly and trivia, acting silly as hell and stupid, acting immature and laughing and full of folly. You don't find that. If he does, he's not a spiritual man. I don't give a damn who it is. You go around his house, you see nothing there but nettles and thorns. But thorns, the cares of this world that chokes out the life of Yah. He's concerned with this natural proclivity and not with the spiritual things. No, hell man, you want to find a wife. You don't want to find sex. You can find that all day long. Hell, you want a wife. You want favor with Yah. And the scripture gives us a beautiful identity of the characteristics of what a wife is and what one is not. And I will get to that. Hallelujah. Makes no difference whether you like me. Where you need to begin is begin to hate the garment, your own garment, that you have allowed your flesh to spot. That's where you need to begin your hatred. That's where you need to begin your dislike for, all right? And Salomo says in 24:32, I saw and I considered it well. He said, I pondered this house. I looked at this man. I pondered every aspect. I looked at it. I looked upon it. And he said, and I receive alakha. I receive. Look what he says now. He did not just say, he said, I receive musa. I receive instructions. What is musa? It is to chastise. Correct. To straighten one out. You tell this damn foolish man to straighten him out. He becomes wild in his approach. He becomes asinine. You tell a silly, foolish woman, she can never see her stupidity, her ways. Shlomo said, I looked at this crazy man's house. I looked at the thorns on the walls broken down. You know, I look every day and I go and I'm always pulling something up, weeds or something. And I say to myself all the time, I say, you know, Yah, if this place wasn't taken care of, I find trees growing everywhere. I find oak trees, I find pine trees, I find them growing in little crevices of places you sit. I say, would not take long that you will find trees everywhere. The windows will break out and everything. And so it is in the spiritual house. If we don't continuously refresh and guard this house and cause it to be cleansed and to be swept, that's what happens to us in our hearts. All kinds of thistles and thorns and unclean things began to grow in us. And we look for our desire and our pleasure in the world. And that's where some of us has gone. We have gone. He said, then I saw this and I considered it. I looked at myself. If I'm not right, then you ought to look at me and consider how wrong I am. And then you ought to allow that to be instructions to you. It ought to be Musa. It ought to be a discipline. It ought to chastise you. But hell, that's not the way we do it. She is wrong. He is wrong. No, you are wrong. You dirty little heifer. You foolish man. You are wrong. A wise man said, I saw all of that, I considered all of that, and it was instructions unto me. It was muzah, it was discipline, it correct me, it chastised me, it showed me where I was wrong. Now, we don't do that, do we? No, he's wrong, she's wrong. No, you're wrong, woman. Shut your damn mouth, man. Shut up, woman. You're not even acting like a woman. Hallelujah. This is hardcore here today. Hallelujah. I don't care if you don't love me. He said, then I saw and considered it well. I looked upon it and I received instruction. He said, just by me looking upon it, I received Musa. I received the disciplines of Yah, the correction. He says this in verse 33. Yet a little or mi'ach, just a small tiny bit, a little sleep. Shani, a little sleep, just a little sleep. A little sleep and a little slumber, a little folding of hands to sleep, so shall poverty resh. So shall poverty come upon one that travels a halach or depart for the lack as a runner. Just like a runner, because they don't have the endurance, they don't have the ability to endure the pace, then they begin to slope and they give up. That's what a runner does. And those that lack wisdom and understanding of Yah, and those that lack the understanding of the way Yah builds his house, that's the way they're going to fade, because they have no understanding of what Yah says. And so when things do not meet their criteria, then they're ready to accuse everyone. When you find people accusing people, it's because things have not met their criteria, so they accuse everyone. You're the dirty beast. No, it's not that everyone, you're the dirty beast. You understand? So they began to accuse everyone. Well, I don't like the preaching there. Go to hell, Jezebel. I'm glad you don't like it. It's the preaching. It's amazing that people that have love from here call others, and yet that preacher down there, and it would be acceptable, if the individuals would ever study the Torah, if they don't even study, they don't even read, they don't even love Yah, they spend no time, but yet you think I will let a fool like that correct me? You're wrong. I will let your foolish ways do that. I'm like Shlomo here. I look at things and I learn. They instruct me. They correct me. I was talking with my ish the other day, and I said, I have learned so much by watching, observing other men. I didn't know how to be a man. I didn't know what it was to love a wife. But I watched men that, even though they did not know what they were doing, and that was my correction. That was my instruction. Those things taught me, this is the approach. This is what you must do. These are the things you do. That's how I learn. I've learned so much from just observing, observation. Not quick to speak, just observing. You're not going to come here or a place like this 4 or 5 months a year. You're going to make observation. I've been here 17 years. And hell, you're going to tell me. You're going to tell me something wrong. Go to hell, man. Go to hell, woman. You're the one that's wrong. No, the place is not wrong. Isn't that amazing? And yet they can go to Walmart and Kmart. They will never say they're wrong in their prices. No, they will not. They can spend all day in the world. They will never say, these folks are robbing me. They're taking my money. They don't say that. Yet when it comes to the messenger, the people of Yah, they can always find a place to critique. And yet with the same judgment, they don't critique themselves that way. Because if they did that, they would be strong and powerful. They would have the resolve of Yah. You see the beauty of Yah. They don't have a damn thing. The world has taught you your beauty is in your flesh, and your flesh is like a cake. It stinks. You know, when a man dies within seconds, there's certain worms that form in his body. That there are different stages of different worms that began. It takes the body about 3 to 5 years. I don't care if you're embalming or what. For the worms, as soon as you die, they began to eat. As soon as you die, they began to eat. It is a period between 3 to 5 years before there's one stage of worms that come in, and then when they eat and die out, there's another that evolved from that. And then when they eat it out, then there's a last stage like a beetle. That worm consumes everything. It gets the marrow, get everything off the flesh. There's nothing left there but the whiteness of the bones. No diseases and nothing at all. Nothing but bones. And that's what the word of Yah has to do. It has its beginning process. It has its central or middle process. And then it has the finishing work. And we need to get to that finishing stage where there's no sin, there's no ill in us that do not reflect the ways of Almighty Yah, YisraYah. We need men and women to be forthright, honest with us, and tell us our stupidity and show us our jive childish ways, that we can maturate and mature as strong soldiers, warriors of Almighty Yah. That's what we need. Poverty come upon them because we love to sleep. The things of Yah, well, I hear you, yet you did not hear, man. You can tell whether he's a man. You can tell whether she's a woman. You go by the house. You look at the house. You look at how his vineyard is. You look at the order of his house. You look around his house. It was one thing about me that every house I've had, I've always believed in it being immaculate. My yard being mowed. My house inside clean and outside. That's the way I've always been. I've always been that way. Even when I could not bathe, we didn't have water to bathe, I would find ways to bathe. I would boil me water, and the summertime I loved because you could take baths in cold water much easier than you could in the winter. Hallelujah. And my teeth are not all gone either, you understand? Because I didn't have the opportunities or the candies like many of us did have. Hallelujah. He says here, listen to this, Yisrael. I want to begin here. You don't have this, but I wanted Achsimeon to print this out for us all, but it is in the book of Shirach, the wise speech of the student of Yah, the book of Shirach. All of you all should have that. You got money to buy bubble gum and candy gum. You got money for this and that, and for $6-$8 book. No, I'm not going to buy you one. But the book of Shirach, chapter 22. I want to begin here. And I want to speak from things out of the book of Shirach. It's vitally important. Look what it says in the book of Shirach, 21. It talks about this slothful man. It says, a slothful man, a man that is lazy in the principles of Yah, do not hold fast to the standards of Yah, is compared to a filthy, nasty stone. He's not worth a damn. A man that do not hold fast to the principles of the order of Yah, he is as a filthy stone. And everyone will express contempt to his dishonor. When a man do not stand in the principles of Yah, even his friends will talk under their breath and say, Dave Roberts is a cowardly little weak thing. They will say that Raah Dawid is a weak preacher. Even him, when he is a slothful man, when he is a reash, when he is a man that is lazy, he doesn't labor in the Torah, he doesn't bring forth the power of Yah's resolve unto the bosom of Yisrael, even he will be a contempt unto the people. Even the women will say, he has nothing. There's nothing about him. That's why we need watchers and mighty men today. I got a message I'm going to preach on that one day, Yah grants it to me, a mighty man. Oh, the Katve talks about mighty men. And we need some mighty men among us. Mighty man, strong man. Hallelujah. He says in verse 2 that a slothful man, a lazy man, A slothful man. Why would a woman want a slothful man? Tell me. A slothful man is compared to the filth of a dunghill. Do you all hear that? A man that is slothful in the affairs of Yah. A man that has no time for Torah, but he got time for Walmart and Dollar Mart. It says that man is compared to the filth of a dunghill. You got every kind of filthy thing in a dunghill. That's what a slothful man. What a man is not attentive to the Torah of Yah. When his house doesn't abide in the principles of the Torah of Yah, you have a filthy house. You have a stinking house. It stinks. And every kind of unclean spirit comes into that house. And his friends, his neighbors, his association, it's like a dunghill. He stinks. I have met men, there have been those that lived here, they had every day of their life, even when they bathed, they had a natural stench in their body. They stink. I don't care when they took a bath, put on cologne, they even stink. They were stunkers. They always stink. So a man's house, when he is slothful in the affairs of Yah, when he is not about the business of Yah, he is like the filth of a dunghill. He's a stinking, dirty, filthy, doggish man. Now, who would want that? Would a wife want that? So a wife prepares herself for a man of strength and value when it comes to Yah, doesn't she? And so when he finds her, he knows what he has. So a man that doesn't operate in the Ruach of Yah, he is compared. He's equivalent to the stench, equivalent to the filth of a dung here. And dung is that stuff that comes out of your poop. That's what he's compared to. So can you imagine 10,000 pounds of dung right out of here? You understand that during the middle passage of the people of the diaspora, that when they shackled those people in those bows of those ships, that they would defecate and excrete all kind of excrement on them, and they would never clean them. It was written and said that you could literally smell the ships 5 miles outside of the port. The inhumane, cruel ways of this degradation to a human being, to mankind. Their feces and their excrement. Thousands of miles, and they sail in that kind of filth. And so when a man doesn't take care of his house, it is that nature. When his house is overrun, when he has no spiritual lawns, when he has no strength, that man, he's slothful. He's lazy. He doesn't want to get up on his feet and fight the battle. That man is compared to the filth of a dunghill. Anyone that pick it up with anyone, and it says, and anyone that picks it up will shake it off of his hand. Anyone that meets a man like that, anyone that touches a man like that, when he meets him, he wants nothing to do with that man anymore. Have you ever met people you don't want to have anything to do with them? I know I have. There have been those that come through here, I don't want to even deal with them again. I will never deal with them. You understand? So the man that picks that man up, or he receives that man, once he does that, he never wants to be around that man again because he is lazy. He is shiftless in the things of Yah. When a man has no time for Yah, when everything is an aversion to Yah, something is wrong. He's not a strong man. When he got time for everything, come on, but no time for Torah. No time to teach his sons and his daughters the beauty of Torah that his daughter understands. I don't give a damn how tired he is, what time he comes home. Makes no difference at all. It's amazing that because when I was a young man, when I was younger, I had a full-time job, and sometimes I worked 2 jobs, and I have. I went to school full-time, and I always had to take my chetve with me to study the scripture, the Torah. I always did that. I didn't care what time I got home at night. I will always study. I would take time with Yah. So when a man doesn't do that, then he's a filthy man. I don't give a damn who the man is. I don't care what his aspirations are. He's like a filth of a dunghill. And not only that, but Shlomo says in Proverbs, Mishlei 19:15, He says, slothfulness, when a man is slothful at la, when he is lazy, he says, slothfulness casts one into a deep sleep, and an idle nefesh shall suffer hunger. Now that's why we're hungering. Not for bread, because we eat plenty of bread. Look at us. Look at us. I don't care how thin you may be, you still love bread you eat. That doesn't mean you don't eat because you're still greedy. We're greedy people. So it's not that. Hallelujah. You know, because one thinks that they're smaller than someone, they think that they have a much greater beauty than someone else. You're a silly woman. You're immature man. You're silly. You're so immature. But that doesn't grant to you, like me and others that are much overweight, you don't sustain that either. All right? You take heed to yourself. Don't get upset with me. Just hear me. If you get upset with anyone, get upset with you. You're the one that's causing you the problem. You're the one. You're not my problem because I eat like a hog. You're not my problem because I like fried chicken and steak and baked potato. You're not my problem. I am my problem. You're not my problem because I like cake. I love cake. And the only reason I haven't eaten anything, although my little back there, little Abner, he's trying to egg me on. I ask him, is it all right if I eat that? And of course, he always answers me, I don't know. Well, I know what he's trying to do. He's egging me on for the $50 spot because I told him I'm not going to eat anything sweet until Tabernacle. And so when I ask him, he said, what is that? He said, go ahead. Eat it. So what he's trying to do is egg me on. I said to him the other day, I said, I sure would like, love to have some yogurt. He said, you don't want that. You want yogurt. Now, cake is better. So I am my own problem. No one else is your problem. No one else has caused you the agony. You caused you the agony. No one has caused you to have or to grapple with such pains. You are the one. Your attitude, your character, your personality, you are the one that's at fault. But your easy way out, because we're cowardly, we love to blame someone else. He doesn't like me. You're not even a likable individual, man. That's why I don't like you. I would say to those that were here, I don't like you, man. I'm just telling you. I don't like you. Because you're not likable. I don't want to hug you. And I would not embrace them. I would not lay hands suddenly on men like that. And even when I did, that was some kind of a, I was conscious of still their attitude was still the same. Come on, YisraYah. You've gotten this false perception of what Yah's love is, what we think is love. Hell, if you don't love yourself, how can you love me when you don't even discipline yourself and straighten yourself out? When you can't see the ills of yourself, you know you can't love me, woman. Come on. You're silly. You can't see your own error, your own faults. You can't see what is interesting in you. You're going to tell me you love me. You don't give a damn about me. Well, you can't see you operating outside of the Torah of Yah. You're doing things that are not according and based upon the principles of the Torah. And you tell me you love me? If you love Yah, then do what he commands us. If you love Yeshua, do what he commands us. You don't love me. You can't love me. You're basing things on this little emotion, this little feeling. You think it's love. You think it's sensual, it's sexual, and it's not even that. You don't know anything about love. You need to learn what love is. That's why you need elderly daughters to teach you. You see a woman that knows how to appease her husband, you watch her, you ask her, and let her teach you how to be a wife. Hell, that's what you do. When a man is faithful to his wife, he loves her, he honors her, and you can see that, you can see it in the, I will show you, you can see it in his face. If I was a discontented thing with this woman right here, you would know it. I would not know how to entreat you. So you ask someone, what do you do to that man? What do you do for him? Come on. It is right, my Ima. This pride, you think you know, you don't know a damn thing. That's our problem. I want the devil to get mad at me. I love to fight the devil. Get mad, devil. That's right. Hallelujah. Get mad, devil. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Moving quickly. Again, here in Proverbs, 12:4, Wherefore? Now, this is the condition of a man. We can see that when he is slothful and lazy, he ain't worth a damn. You look at him, look at his spirit. You can look at the way he carry himself. You can look at his physical condition. It means a lot as to what his spiritual nature of mind is. But the question is asked when Shlomo and all of his great battles and all of his tremendous agonies, he says here, he says, a virtuous or a chayil, a virtuous woman. She's a woman of strength. She's a woman of beauty. She's a woman that is efficient. She's a woman of character. A virtuous woman is a crown to her husband. You hear that, daughters? That's what, are we not the crown? If we're going to be the diadems of his crown, are we not going to be a virtuous woman? That's what a virtuous woman is. She's a crown to her husband. I will show as I go why. As I go farther, I will show you why she's a crown. She's a beauty. She is the authority of his kingdom. She plays the beauty of his kingdom. That's what a virtuous woman is. Not just a woman, a virtuous woman. A virtuous woman. She's a crown to her husband. She's a crown to her husband. And she that maketh the shame is rachab. She is rottenness in the bones. When a woman makes a man ashamed, she is like the stench of the decaying rottenness of a bone. That's why when a man, he suffered immensely with a woman, he doesn't want to touch that thing again because there's rottenness in her. That's why y'all say, give her a writing of divorcement. That's why he said, write that woman a divorcement. Leave her and go away from her. You don't even touch her again. You can't even go back and marry her. Now, if you divorce her, you marry, and then this wife dies, and she marries to get a husband, then only then, but you can't at this thing. We got divorced, so we remarried. No, that's not of y'all. The Torah teacher gives that because he says she's unclean. That's just a fact, Yisrael. When a woman makes a man ashamed, when she brings shame upon a man, she is like rottenness or a decaying corruption in his bones. She is a vile stench. She stinks. He doesn't want to be around her because she stinks. She is hideously ugly. That's the truth now. And we dealt with the slothful man. We're going to deal with the woman because her place is prominent and it's vitally important. She stinks. And there's nothing like a stinking woman. Physically and above all, spiritually, you find a stinking, dirty woman that's what we are as a people unto Yah, as a bride. We're stinking dirty. It ain't nothing like a woman that stinks. Her body odor is different than a man. Her stench is different. Nothing like it. It stinks. And that's what she is like. A woman that makes a man ashamed. Her ways. Come on, a beautiful woman that's betrothed to a man, she wants to bring beauty upon the man. She wants to bring a crown. That man, he sure got a gem. Then when every man sees the woman, say, man, he's got a woman. You understand that? He's got a woman. Man, you come on, we just meet him out here. Let's whistle for him. He's got a beautiful woman. When a man sees a woman, he'll know whether she's a beautiful woman. There's a beautiful woman. Other men will say, well, she's a beautiful woman. Well, she's not beautiful, man. You gonna marry her? Huh. You're gonna have some trouble, man. Sure, they see that. You gonna marry that thing? That man, come on, boy. Don't go there yet. Just hold off. Just wait a while. Oh, it's the truth. You that are listening, that's contemplating, you that are here, you better be careful. Come to me and ask me my advice. Hallelujah. Ask me. I will tell you. Do I marry him? No. Do I marry her? Uh-uh, man. Mm-mm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who can find a virtuous woman? She's a crown to her husband, and she that maketh him ashamed is like rottenness to the bone. So a woman that is virtuous, she is chayya, she's full of the strength of Yah, she loves Torah, she's always about the business of Almighty Yah. Then you have a gem of a woman. She's a beauty. She's a gem. She has strength. She has beauty. The world has taught the women not to have that. There are women that lay up all day long and watch soap operas. fictitious life. And then, believe me, daughters, I love you. You out there, you would do the same thing. I give a damn what you think. You live in bed to 10, 11 o'clock. Don't let people pretend. They're those that will put on a superficial front. And we're all excellent at doing that, aren't we? Yeah, we are. We pretend like we got something. Yeah. But you will be found out. It won't take you long. And that's a fact. You don't have to buy it. But it's still the truth. You will find some form of soapy to give your attention to and your heart to. Not to Yah, but to the soapy. I want to move quickly to the book of Sirach. Hallelujah. This is Sirach 25. He's talking about a wicked and a virtuous woman here. I want you to hear this carefully. Listen to me. Sirach 25, verse 13. I want to begin. This is what Sirach says here. Hear this. Your daughters, you need to clean yourselves up. Your sons of Yisrael, you need to get strong in the power of the might of Yah. And that is the witness, the testimony of Yahshua, your rush, your head, that he is your head. But this is what the messenger of Yah says here in Sirach 25, verse 13. He says to Yah, he says, Yah, bestow upon me or give me nagal, give me wounds or plagues, diseases, the mark of leprosy. This is what he asked now. Listen now. He said, give me that, but the wound of the heart and any wickedness and the resha, the wickedness of a wife. He said, give me wounds, give me leprosy, give me scars, but don't give me the wounds of a heart of a wicked, of a resha, a woman whose mind is not governed by the Torah of your discipline. He said, I'd rather have cancer. I'd rather have leprosy. I'd rather have any kind of wound than to have this wound here. That's why, man, woman, you better be careful. He said, give that to me than to give me the wickedness or the wounds of a wife. Hear me. He says, and any affliction, I don't care if I'm in poverty, but the affliction from them that hate me, and any revenge, but not the revenge of my enemies. He says to Yah, there is no venom worse than snake's venom, and no wrath or chema, this hot displeasure, worse than the enemy's wrath. He goes on to say in verse 16, he said, I'd rather dwell or live with a lion and a dragon, a behemoth, than to keep house with an evil, wicked woman that has not the Torah, the law of Yahramah. He said, I'd rather live in the cage with a lion than to live with a damn wicked woman. I'd rather live with dragons and bohemians than to be accommodated by an evil woman with a mind will not allow the Torah to address her condition and to show her the state of her mind, that she is far from Yah. He said, I'd rather live with lions and dragons than to live with a woman that's evil and wicked, that doesn't give a damn about Yah. She has no spirit of truth in her. He said, I'd rather live that way. I would too. I would. Well, that's not the writing in the rights. Well, this is what Shlomo says in Proverbs. I'm going to continue from Sirach. This is what he says in Proverbs 21 and verse 9. He said, it is better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than with a brawling woman in a white house. A woman that loves discord, a woman that loves to talk, a woman that loves to answer according to her corrupting her bosom. He said, I'd rather live in the corner of a shack. I'd rather live in the corner of the rooftop by myself than to deal with a woman that is contentious, a woman that talks too damn much. She thinks she's talking and she ought to be quiet. And when she thinks she's quiet, she's running her mouth. He said, give me the quarter where nobody there. I'd rather dwell there, y'all, than to be with a contentious woman. Hallelujah. I'd rather live with lions and dragons than to keep house with an evil woman. He says this in verse 17. The wickedness of a woman change her face. He said, and you can look at them. He said, it's the darkness of her countenance is like that of a bear. That she's always aggressive. She wants to let you know how she feels. She wants to let you know how she stands. She wants to let you know how you stand. She wants to let you know her damn twisted mind. And you look at her, you can see her whole countenance. And she says she loves you. Don't even know what love is, you damn fool. Yeah. And you lazy, slothful, weak, jackleg man that has no strength or the character of y'all. You allow that. You are a weak, cowardly thing. What woman wants a man like that? Oh, I'm going to get to the real nitty-gritty in this, all right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says that her husband shall sit, take his meal among his friends. Instead of eating with her, he'd rather eat among his friends. And when he hears it, when he hears her, he cannot sighing bitterly. When he hears a voice, he gets vexed. When a man has a disregard for a wife, a woman, when he hears a voice, he doesn't want to hear a voice. He doesn't want to hear her talking. He doesn't want her to talk to him because she vexes him. Because she brings vexation to the man. We might as well get real. This is to dress your daughters up. Dress your men up. Put your clothing. So he'd rather be away from home. He'd rather sit in the bar all night and sip drinks with his friends. So man rather sit with his friends and sit with them. And all of a sudden, he can hear the sounding of a voice. He said, oh, it causes him to be vexed. She talks to him. He said, what do you want? It shouldn't be like that. Because she doesn't realize what's in her. She doesn't see herself. She thinks of herself as a gem. But she is not precious. She is not. And what a man tolerates that because he's a weak, insecure man. And a woman needs a secure man of strength. Not verbally abusing. Not physically abusing, but that's what she needs. That's what she needs, a man that deals with strength and correction from Yah. That's why the women today, they cannot, when they see a true man, they despise that. That's why even Shlomo, his Ema said, son, of all things, don't give your strength unto the woman. This man had plenty of women, so it could not have been a sexual thing, YHWH. He was looking for something that was greater than that. And see how the enemy has robbed the women today. They think it's all about some kind of physical thing. It's not about a physical thing. It's something beyond that. It's the beauty that beyond the physical thing. And it's not you dressing up in some damn shoes this high and thinking you're looking fine. You look silly trying to walk like that. Your feet hurt, woman. That's one thing. I don't want my feet hurting not one bit. I'm not going to have it. I don't want no shoes too tight. Not at all. I want my feet, my toes made. No, I don't want no shoes that like that. I'm not going to wear anything like that. Thinking I'm looking nice and my feet are hurting? Come on, YHWH. I'm going to progress on. Is that all right? You get mad. A warrior loves a fight. So I love to fight, all right? Okay. Hallelujah. She said her husband, he sits in verse 19. It says, not some, but all of you in Ovon, call all iniquity and injustice or evil unrighteousness. Listen now, it is bulls. It is insignificant. It has no comparison. It is insignificant compared to a wife's wickedness. When she defies the Torah of her head, when she defies, that's what the enemy has. He has the women today just talking back and saying, and just saying every kind of wicked thing. He said, all iniquity, that's what he said, all wickedness and all injustice cannot even be compared to the iniquity of an evil wife when she goes outside of the realm of Torah. And that's why the enemy have you doing things, daughters, that desire, and makes you ugly. And so when a man looks at you, he says, look at that ugly, beastly looking thing. He despises you. And that's the truth. You look ugly. You don't look nice. And that's why he sits women up before him. And she, because of the physical attributes, she looks like, I don't give a damn how fine you are, how voluptuous, how you think you look. It's all that emanates out of your heart, daughter. You need correction. Correction every day, all day, all the time. I took a bath this morning, but I got to take another one. I can sense the oozing of stench and the vileness of my own body oozing out and my perspiration. My breath stinks. I can't brush my teeth once a month. Two or three times a day. At least that. All iniquity and injustice is insignificant as booze compared to the wise iniquity. He says, let the portion of a sinner's lot befall her. Let that which is the reward of a wicked sinner fall upon a wife like that. See, we've been taught, well, as she was sweet, she was not sweet. She was not nice. Let's get real, YisraYah. She was wicked. He was a coward. I don't care if it is your son. I don't care if it is your daughter. Tell the truth. She was a Jezebel. He was a weak thing. He couldn't stand in the strength of Yah. So he become deranged. He goes running away from Yah because this has happened. Turns his back on Yah. Come on, YisraYah. Let's get real. Let's not be full of pretense. Well, he's going to be. No, he's not going to be all right. She's not going to be all right. The sinner's lot is going to fall upon her. You say what you want to. Hallelujah. He says, as the climbing up a sandy way is to the feet of the age, and I'm getting age. And there are us in here that are getting age. You're trying to go up a sandy hill as being barefooted and don't have shoes on. But you're trying to go up a sandy hill with age. It says, so is the garrison or this kind of attitude, and garrulous is one that is full of rambling, and they love to talk, and they love to make their point, they love to make their opinion, they love to show you what's right, they love to tell you what they want you to hear. They're always rambling, they're always talking. You say something, they always got something to say. So is a talkative. She is long-winded. She's always wanting to talk. She's always going to prove her point. She's always going to answer back. She's always got something to say. Shut your damn mouth. The girl, listen. She loves to talk. She's like, well, I want to say my... No, just be quiet. And a girl is... Then a wife full of words to a quiet husband, to a shachatz. What is a quiet husband? He's a man that... Well, a man at the time, he just wants to be at shalom. Just don't talk. Just leave me alone for a while. So she is to a quiet husband. A man that take confidence in the shalom of Yah and the Torah of Yah. When a woman just talks... He says something, she got 1,000 words to reply to that. That's wrong, daughters. He says one thing, she's wanting to show him. She's literally going to show him where he's wrong. And the more she talks, she's going to show him how wrong he is. Yah will show him where he's wrong. He will bring conviction on the man. He will show him. He'll send a man to show him where he's wrong. He'll send a man like me. If he sees a man like me, he'll run. He'll show him where he's wrong. He will. And so what you will do, you will destroy the strength of the character of a man. You think you're doing something wonderful, but you're not. You think you're operating in the spirit that's right, but you're not operating in a right spirit. You know, there have been folks, there was one individual that came here. I was talking to one, and I intrigued this woman correctly and right, honor her. So she says that, quote, that all the men there in Victory, they dress fly, and the women dress like bag women. I say, where's this? This a liar, this Jezebel, you know. Yet the same woman that says she loves me, I'm a pastor, she loves me greatly. These damn, when they talk like that, get away from me. I'd rather you never tell me you love me than your fruit to be seen and recognized. That our women dress like bag women. I said, that's a lie. I said, my issue, she makes all of her clothes. And she's not a bag woman. That's not the truth. Women don't dress like that. I say, what a liar. I say, why can't they tell me that? Because they're afraid to tell me. They're afraid.
You will be surprised the things that some of those that say they love me. You will be surprised. Hallelujah.
That's all right. I'm dealing with us now. I'm not dealing with the world. I'm dealing with Yisrael, his house, his people. That's who I'm dealing with. It says to us men, do not be ensnared, do not be overtaken by a woman's beauty or her charm. Don't be overtaken by that man because she thinks she is voluptuous. She's shapely. Well, you're not shapely, woman. Come on. Every woman is not shapely. She may think she's shapely. But she's not shapely. Every woman is not shapely. That's a fact. So don't be ensnared because she thinks she's pretty and she thinks she's fine. Think she's got something. Don't be ensnared. Don't be caught by that man. You can find what we call, as far as physically attractive women, you can get them a nickel a dozen. That's the truth. That's the truth, daughters of Tizayon. That's why Yah speaks to you, us, that you will be a wife, that your wife, your ish will take pleasure in you all the days of his life. He will enjoy you. He has no desire for no other takings. That's what you want to do. And see, the world has caused you to act like the world, and then you will find yourself and your ish doing the same thing the world is doing. So you want to make yourself beautiful, not only inwardly, but outwardly too. That's what you do. You want when your man, when he comes home from a hard day's work, you don't want to look like a bag woman. You don't want to lay up in the bed all day long and do nothing. And that's a fact. He wants to see the beauty of his charm when he comes in the house. I don't care what kind of day he had, even though he may be all moody, you still do that. Hallelujah. See, we have learned how to answer and to talk back. And you have caused more damage and irreparable things in your marriage that will never be repaired. Unless there's a total commitment from him and you, it will never be repaired. And that's the truth. Do not be ensnared by a woman's beauty, and do not desire a woman for her pleasure and her possession. He says, There is wrath and impugnance. He said, there's wrath and impugnance and great reproach when a wife supports her husband. It tells us a dejected mind and a gloomy face and a wounded love are caused by an evil wife. When a man looks dejected, when he looks downpressed, when his heart is torn to pieces, it's because of an evil wife. That's what he says, because of an evil wife. A wicked woman abates the courage. She will take the strength or try to abate the courage of a man to stand strong. And wise, when you operate that way, you're wicked. When you're trying to abate his courage, you're wicked. She will abate the courage. She will make a heavy countenance and a wounded love. You will see dropping hands in the man. You will see weak knees. Caused by a wife who does not make her husband shelah. That is not eshab shelah. Who does not make her husband to prosper, to be at rest, to have quietness. That is what that word here, happy, means shelah. How do you know? By diligent research. That's what a beautiful wife does. She calls her husband she makes him shelah, for him to be at rest, for him to find comfort. Even just in her presence when he's not talking, he finds comfort with the woman. He has this ease and this comfort with her. He found himself full of the shelah of Yah. There's contentment with him. Not when she is garrulous, when she is loquacious, always talking. Always got to talk. That's not what Yah intended for you to be, daughter Tizayon. That's why when he saw man was lonely, he made him a wife. You're not ready. You think you are. Listen, there have been those that were here wanted me to marry them. I would not marry them. And I said, not me. No, I'm not marrying you. You go somewhere. When you do that, just go find your places. You're not. Come on. he's a fool here, she's a fool here. Two fools igniting. No, I'm not going to be a part of it. Hallelujah. I've had one time where I say to my Isha, well, I want him to marry he and I by July this date. I said, tell her, I said, go to hell. That's the way I said it. I said, tell the woman, I said, go to hell. Tell her that. Now she's going to tell me. I said, tell her, I said, go to hell. So she set another date where by August the 29th, 15th, I said, tell her, I said, damn her, and go flat to hell. She's going to set a date for me to do. Nah. And the juvenile that she wanted me to marry her to, he was too dumb and too ignorant. He thought you couldn't tell him nothing anyway. But I told the woman, tell her go to hell. I don't know, she set two dates for me. I said, tell her go to hell. Tell her, I said, go to hell. I said to him, you can take out that marriage anytime you want to. You take out there. I don't give a damn. But as far as me, I'm not going to bless it. That's a fact. Hallelujah. Do what you want to. You're your man. You're your man. You're your woman. Do what you want to. Just don't involve me. Hallelujah. You might as well love me. I'm glad that you're so honest, man. An honest man. It's nice to have an honest man. And straightforward and honest. He doesn't talk the language like some of the others. I had a group to write me. The leader of this group wrote me from Philadelphia. And told me that one of the elders, Zachin, told me about you. And we're looking to get between 100 and 200 acres in South Carolina, Georgia, to start a community. I said, wow, they must have a lot of money because 100 to 200 acres here in this part of the country now, it costs you $300,000 for 100 acres if you can get it that cheap. It depends on where you get it. You're going to pay at least $200,000. And in Georgia, it may be even more expensive. And so the man leaves me his telephone number and says, you call me. Well, you would think, man, if you wrote me a letter, why don't you call me? So I responded, you go to the website, you need to see. You might as well listen to some of my preaching because you may not like me when you hear me. Well, I haven't heard back from the man since. I haven't heard anything from him. So it doesn't matter. I'm not one that is captivated by emotions. I've watched the many. I've watched them go. I've watched them come. So I'm not troubled by that. All right? Hallelujah. Can I move on? I'm going to finish this today, all right? Hallelujah. It tells us that this is the expression of Yah, what we don't understand. This is what we've caused the heart of Yah to go through this great agony because we are not the kind of woman, the kind of bride that he's coming for, YisraYah. And it caused great agony to him. It says in verse 24, from a woman, sin had its beginning. And because of her, we all die. Was it not the not? Shaul says to Timothy, it was not the man that was deceived, but it was the woman that was caught in transgression. Did he not tell her that? And so when a man receives that from a woman, he dies. Women can kill a man, kill his passion, kill his love, kill his fervor, kill his desire, because it was sin that was created in her, not that she's less than a man. She fell just like man fell. And because of her, because of sin, and because of her, we are the her. Because of us, then sin is in the world today. Because we disobey the Torah of Almighty Yah. We defy it. We have no respect for Yah. We have no honor. We have honor for thieves and liars, but no honor for Yah at all. Hallelujah. You cannot learn the ways or the discipline of a wife unless you're taught by a woman like this. You must be taught by a wife, a virtuous, a high heel, a woman of strength and character and beauty in order what it is to be a wife. You must see the beauty of a man, in order to understand the strength and the beauty of a man. And you don't see much of that today, YisraYah. You see a lot of foreignness and falseness. That's what you see permeate the land. He tells us to give the water no passage. To give the water no passage, add no ooze, no boldness. See, women think because they can talk. Listen to this, you daughters. I want you to hear it. He said, don't give no boldness, no ooze, no might or strength. Don't give her no personal, social, or spiritual power that she thinks she has. He said, and no boldness of speech to an evil wife. You know she's evil because she's running a damn. Don't give them no boldness. Don't let them talk over you. Don't give them that power to say, well, I want to do that. No, don't let them do that. Don't give them that boldness of speech. You never give a wife that. No, woman. If there's anything that arouses me, don't do that to me. Don't try to talk over me, woman. Don't try to talk along with me. Don't do that. Do anything, but don't do that. Don't give her no ooze. Don't give her no boldness of power. You don't let her talk over you. Well, hold up now. No, I'm not holding up. That's an evil spirit. You quiet, huh? That's all right. You men quiet too, because undoubtedly you allow me to do that. I ain't gonna allow that. I'm not gonna allow my woman to do that. Nah, if it's anything that causes me to become irate, don't talk with boldness of speech. Don't try to correct me that way, woman. Don't do that, please. You will have the beauty of my love, my tenderness, my kindness, my compassion. I know all of that. You will have my caressing. You will have my, you can feel my bosom. You can lay your head. But don't talk to me that way. Don't try to bowl. Don't try to show me where I'm wrong. Don't do that. Just leave that alone. I will know what I'm wrong, and I'll tell you what I'm wrong. But don't do that, all right? Just leave it alone. It's your shalah, the beauty of your quietness, that will cause my heart to be convicted, because you're a beautiful thing, your wife. You're my crown. You will cause my heart to be convicted. I will come back. I will tell you I'm wrong, but don't do that. Don't ever give a wife the boldness of speech. Your wife, you don't even want that. Don't even do your man like that. Don't do your husband like that. Don't try to talk over him. Don't try to present don't try to present your cause. He will understand your cause. I don't care how ignorant he is. Hallelujah. It says this. I didn't say that, all right. It said, and give her no boldness, no ooze, no might. Don't let her have her little political speech, her little social speech. Don't give her no boldness or speech and an evil woman. If she does not go as you direct her, if you said, come on, stop. She, and then she wants to, no. Don't do me like that, woman. Please don't do that. You say, just stop. Well, that's an evil woman. If she doesn't go as you direct her, you are her Baal. It's better just to be quiet. Don't say anything. Let him rage like a fool. And then in the quietness of his time, he'll know he's a fool. He will. We got quiet, didn't we? I can imagine how quiet you are out there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says, if she does not go, and she does not do, if she doesn't respond, if she does not go as you direct her, as you say, it shall stop. She's got to say a little more. You say, it shall, look, stop. All right? She got to say a little more. Look, go ahead. If she doesn't go as you say, separate her from yourself. Say, get out of my face, woman. You separate yourself from her, because what she will have you doing is something that's not beneficial to you. Just go ahead. You separate. Just go ahead. Just go. No. Just go on. Go on. This is what Shirach says. Oh, you like the stuff that you read that doesn't indict us, don't we? He indicting us. He said, if she doesn't do as you commands her, as you tells her, just separate yourself from her. And that's what men do. Even in the world, they do that. They began to have the discord. He said, that's it. He leaves the house, doesn't he? Does he not leave the house? He'll leave the house because he doesn't want to hear that. This is something that Yah put in. He puts that. I don't care if he's a wicked man. Yah put that there. It's there. It's an innate ability. It was born in him. He put that in man. He breathed into man, and every man has the breath of his ruach. That's why it's going to be a terrible thing to have taken that breath and utilized it to assault him, to sin against him. So every man has that. And so when a woman does that, he said, now, hold up. Oh, look, I'm gone. Okay, go ahead. Just go on. Go ahead. I'm out of here, okay? That's what he does. So when you sense that out of her, get out of her, get away from you right then. Don't even let her prolong it. Don't even let her continue to talk. You just say, that's it. When she doesn't do, if she, okay, that's it. Okay, that's enough. Well, no, hold up, daughter. Hold up now. Stop. Well, I can't say, well, stop, okay? Stop now. When I want to speak, you don't never listen to me. Woman, stop, please. When you find that, go away from her. Don't even listen to her. Don't even take no time for that. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to live in no house like that. You're not going to do me like that. When she doesn't go as I direct her, you think I'm going to direct her to go jump off a cliff? Do something that's foolish? You think I'm going to abuse her? I'm her protector. I protect her. I'm here like a bulwark. I'm the one that I will take the spear of the arrow. Come on, I'm here to defend her. No, you don't do it that way, Yisrael. That's her beauty. That's what expresses her beauty. So when she began to talk back, you go from that woman. That's why many men are in prison. They're in situations that are not beneficial to them. And many women are hurt today because of that, because they don't know this is the law of Yah. This is the Torah of Yah. This is your beauty, daughter. Not what you think is your beauty. You're ugly. You're not pretty. You're ugly. You're not physical. There are women that are physically, what the world would call physically unattractive, but they have such a beautiful spirit, they're very attractive. I find more attractive women that way when you can tell. It's one thing about most men. They can tell when a woman has some genuineness to them. They can tell when there's a false woman. Come on, you women can tell when it's a false man, a real man. But you can't tell like a man. Why do you think these whole houses are filled with women? Because these men, those folks down there, you think they're going to leave that faggot down there, Bishop Long? That's all he got down there, faggot men and simple women. And that's just the truth. That's the truth, whether you buy it or not. So mine, he can kind of tell. He can kind of tell. Even when I was a young boy in school, the girls that was not a part of the social political clique, and they kept to themselves. The boys didn't even touch them. Even the most foolish boys had a respect for them. But the hot whores, they didn't have no respect for them. They didn't regard them because they would talk about her with the Jim, Bobby, Billy, and all the rest of them. You understand? They would pray on them and tell everybody how they prayed on them. But this one over here, they didn't mess with her that way because her attitude was different. So when you find a woman that is loquacious, that want to talk around her damn mouth and doesn't want to do what the husband man says, when a woman is betrothed like Miriam and Joseph, she was betrothed unto him. She was found with child. He had not gone into her to seal her. That's what it betrothed. Not no damn dating. You don't date. This is the world. When a man finds a wife, he goes to the head of a Russia and say, man, your daughter's a wife, I want her. And if he grants her, she becomes his wife at that moment. He seals her when he goes into her, Yisrael. So hell, he learns from her. He sees that, well, hold up. Let me give you I don't know if I want to give you a dowry for her because she ain't worth her weight in nothing. That's Yah's way. It's not my way. Is this not my plan? This is what the book says. This is what the writers of the hidden mysteries of the Torah and things that were not found until recently for the people of Yah. This bear witness to everything that's written in the book that you have read all your life. So you go from her presence, you don't let her do that. You go from her presence, you leave her alone. You walk from her presence, hallelujah. He said, if she does not do, verse 26, if she does not go as you direct, I say, baby, stop, all right? Baby, don't do that. He said, separate her from yourself. He said, cut her off from your flesh. Don't even let her arouse you. Say, get out of my damn face, woman. Cut her off from your flesh. Don't even let your flesh be drawn to her. There are men, sometimes they despise a woman because of her attitude. They don't understand that, but they think they got something because they got a genitalia, that they got something that the man is just going to give his soul for. You crazy woman. Silly. Man is not looking for that. Not a man. Not a man. A boy will, but not a man. Not a man. He's not looking for that. Who have you talked to? Well, I've just talked to Yah. This ox back here, I don't talk to him about his person. We don't talk about his situation. We don't need to talk at all. We talk about how to lose this gut and what to do here and what to do there. That's what I mean. I don't talk about his person, fam. Don't need to know. Hallelujah. I don't talk about this person or family. Yabino. No. Don't need to. Regardless of that, this is still for you. You understand? You go from her presence, man. You cut off from your flesh. Don't even let your flesh have no sensitivity there. That's what Yah's going to do. He's going to cut us off. That's right. He cut them off. He destroyed many in the wilderness because they were stubborn and hard-headed. Hallelujah. He destroyed them, Yisrael. He says, cut her off from your flesh. He said, give this woman a bill of divorcement and let her go. Let her go. Don't even allow your flesh to be attached. Don't even allow no sensitivity to be there. Let the woman go. Let her go. Let her go. And you move on. As I said just the other day, there are women that, especially you women of the dark hue, color, skin, there are many women that are dying. And there are women that are secular that would be kind by a man just to say they got a husband. I've seen that here. There was one woman here, she just wanted a husband. And I said to them, no, I will not marry you. You go take her down there and you marry her, but I won't do it, man. And I did not marry them. And the woman did right by the man. It was just the man was a fool. You understand? She didn't want the husband. She would have did whatever it took to satisfy that man. And the women today that would do that. You understand? So your daughters of Tizayon, you need to be polished and refresh. You men, come on, you need to be strong men. Come on, it's not about your physical attraction. It's not about your physical attraction. That's not what a man is attracted to, because one is physical. Most men that are of age have had physical type of relationships. And it did not produce anything at all. Come on. So one physical relationship is no different than another, because he reaches utopic of his desire in any relationship of that nature when it's physical. So what difference does it make? He wants to experience something that is beyond that, that is more beautiful, that when he looks upon her, he senses the beauty of the ikhat, the oneness with him. So you go from the presence of a stupid woman like that. Say, go ahead. That's what you do. You don't try to butter that up and try to resolve that, because you're not going to do it. That's belittling women. No, it's showing you the beauty of a daughter and the fall of a damn fool. He said, go from her and divorce her. Divorce the woman. 26th chapter of Shirah. It says, blessed is the husband that has a virtuous wife. When a man has a hayyel, a woman that is virtuous, he is blessed. Why? Because the number of his days will be double. So when a man have a beautiful, he has a beautiful wife. Has a wife that's walking right. Even his boy say, man, you know your woman, boy, you know she, you know. And he has that chip on his shoulder because he knows she takes care of business. She's not giving him hell. Even though in his wildest, wicked pursuit, she is still doing what she's supposed to do. I'll never forget, and I'm going to finish. You all just bear with me. I was in Europe when I was in the army. There was a man, his name was Sergeant Grimes. I said something to one of the, I may have said it here with you all. And Sergeant Grimes was from North Carolina. So in the military, when you find one that was from your home state, we had this kind of camaraderie as homeboys. And Sergeant Grimes at that time, he was about 45 years old, 46. And I never forgot going to Sergeant Grimes' house. And I was a wicked sinner. But that day, I could have gone up in that man. But if I had touched him, I would have gone to jail. I walked into this man's house. He invited me to dinner because I'm from North Carolina, from Charlotte. And I think it was from some little town not far from here. We were close in proximity, homeboy, you know. So he invited me, come to the house and I have my wife cook us a meal. I said, okay, I'll do that. I never forget one Saturday during the summer in Germany. So I walk into this house. I walk into a house that was so pristine and so clean. It was just crazy. And I knew that that house just wasn't like that because I was there. Everything was order. Everything was in order. I said to the, I can tell you what the woman had on that day. Because when I walked in, I was in such an awe, because I had seen men what they were doing there. And women the same what they were doing. And I knew it was wrong, although it was wicked. And I walked into this man's house, and he had such a pristine place. It was clean. And his wife, she was very beautiful. Her dress, the way she looked. And you could just sense, even though I was a wicked man, the genuine beauty of this woman. And so I look at this man. He begins to interact. And he begins to treat this woman so wrong, even in my presence. I was ready to get up like, no, don't do me like that. I never went back to Sergeant Graham's place again. It caused me to have a distaste for the man. And I was a gambler then. All I wanted to do was break him, take every nickel he had. I didn't like what he did to that woman. But I saw something that day. She was not a brawler. That this woman, even though he treated her that way, she was still kind to this man. And I say the only reason he treated her that way because his guilt and his wickedness. And I knew what the man was doing. That's why he treated her that way. I say, man, I didn't like that. After I ate a little bit, I say, look, go ahead, come on, just take me back. Because I didn't want to be in his place. I didn't want to be in that man's house. To do that woman like that? And if she was a brawler or a combative woman, she would have showed me that. They're like, hold up. You ain't going to diss me here like that. But she was a very beautiful woman. Smallest ever woman. Very, very, her dress was very beautiful. You know, simple, nice. And he was such a guilty man. His conscience burned because of his wickedness, his wrong dealings with her. That's not what Yah wants. A man must, he can't be one that is slothful. He must be about the responsibilities of Yah and taking care of what Yah commands him to do. That he is not slothful to watch his house and not let the weeds grow up around his walls. His house is healthy. He can't allow that. That's why he must always prune and keep things in order, YisraYah. He must do that. And that's the truth. Hallelujah. He said, blessed is the husband that has a virtuous wife. The number of his days will be double. A virtuous, loyal wife caused the husband's heart to rejoice. When you find a virtuous woman, she rejoices her husband. And he will complete his years in shalom, in the peace of Yah, in the shalah, and the confidence of Yah. That's what a beautiful, a wife of strength. See, a virtuous woman, she is a chayil. She is a woman of strength. She has might. She has military power. She is the might of an army. That's what she's like because she stands in the disciplines and the beauty of Yah. And she has this beauty that is beyond expressive terminology. That's what she is. And she caused the man health to his bones, caused him to be strong, and he lives longer. A tough wife is a great blessing. Is Yah Chadol? He uses the same Chadol. A tough wife. She's a pleasant wife. She's a beautiful wife. She is a great blessing. Do you understand that, daughters? The Yah says, you've been a tough wife. You are a great blessing to your ish. A tough wife, but an evil wife. She's a wicked snare to any man. But a tough wife, she's a great blessing. She caused his heart to be fat. She caused strength on his bones. She caused his navel to have life. And see what the enemy has done? A tough wife is a great blessing. A great blessing. A tough wife is a great blessing. She will be granted. She will now. She will be granted among the blessing of the man who fear Yah. Yah says, I'm not granting any man that kind of a woman. Because I'm not giving her unto that kind of cruel system of a wicked man. But when a man fears me, I will grant him a tough wife. Do you all hear that? When a man fears Yah, I will grant him a tough wife. No, we have wanted one because of our flesh, because of our desires, because of our fleshly driven motive. What a man fears Yah, he says, I'll give him a tough wife. She will be granted. Not just given, but granted. She will be nochan. She will be bestowed upon a man like that. She is a grant. You who's granting Yah? She will be granted. Yah said, I'm going to grant her. No, I'm not giving her to that dog. Get away before I kill you. Get away, you pack of pigs. I'll kill you. Get away, you swines. I got my eyes on you. I got my eyes on her, but I see you all. He said, I'm going to take this beauty of a gem, and I'm going to grant her to a man that fears me. Hell, a woman that's rebellious and hard-headed, he's going to give her a man just like that. He's going to give her a lot as a sinner. He raised hell, she's going to raise hell right along with him. That's been some of your proclivity, daughters. You stop that. You turn from that wickedness. Learn the quietness and the beauty of a woman of Yah. Hallelujah. Listen to what he says. He says in verse 4, whether a man be rich or poor, if he has a tough love toward Yah, see, if a man, I don't care what kind of money he got, if he has a tough heart toward Yah, he shall at all time rejoice with a cheerful countenance. He shall be happiest countenance. Riak, I appreciate that. Man, I learned so much. He will always rejoice. You understand? Listen to this. Of three things, he said, there are three things my love is afraid of. And of a fourth, I am afraid. It terrifies me. He said, the slander of a city, because there's nothing but slander, wickedness in a city. He said, the gathering of an unruly mob, because you know they're going to tear you the pieces. He said, a false accusation. You accuse your brothers and sisters. You say that they're not right. You say that they are mistreating you. How are you treating them? Come on. That's wrong, Yisrael. False accusation. All these are worse than death. He said, there is a grief, there's a heartache of love and sorrow when a wife is envious of her achut or her rival or a sister. She's envious of that one because of that one has a more excellent spirit. And so she will degrade them and downgrade them to lift up herself. He said, there's nothing more evil than that. There's nothing more of a grievous heart than that. And a tongue lashing makes it known to all. And she talks about this one, well, this one and that one. She's not nice to me. He is not nice. Come on, that's wrong. That's wicked. We do things because we don't engage ourselves in the book. And because we don't do that, we don't know. And we are easily deceived. So we do things. And it says, and with the tongue lashing, with her tongue, and a tongue lashing makes it known to all. Well, you know this sister's like that. Well, this sister's not kind to me. Well, you know this brother, he's not sweet to me. This brother does me wrong. Come on. And so they make it known to all. Yisrael, that's what they do. Hallelujah. That's what a wife like that, that envious, the chot, the envious those that love Yah, she will always talk about them. So when you find those that want to talk, you know something is wrong with them. When they finish, say, that's you. You know you're wicked, little thing. Woman, you're wicked. This is what he says in verse 7. An evil wife is an ox yoke. You put a yoke on an ox because an ox is a powerful beast. You put a yoke on an ox to drive him in the direction that you want to plow. You yoke him down. An evil wife is an ox yoke and shafts. Take hold of her. It's like grasping a scorpion and a rach. To take hold of a woman, one that you betrothed to, an evil wife that doesn't see her evil ways, is like grabbing a scorpion, Yisrael. That's how dangerous her venomous, her poison is. And a Sadiq, why, she's a blessing. She brings strength and life to any man. She calls him to be happy. Even though he's betrothed to her, he sees her from a distance. He's happy to see her. He hears her voice. It makes his heart glad. When she's an evil and unruly woman, he doesn't want to hear a damn voice. He wants to shut his ears from that, Yisrael. Hallelujah. A woman that travels about habitually. Now, this is what women do. Now, see what they've done. They got Facebook now. They got internet, they got cell phone. I hate to see these silly people walk around with cell phones. They're in these silly, dumb-looking women. They're in line everywhere you see. They want everybody to know, you're so cheap and immature. I mean, the cheapest of individuals got cell phones. And they literally think they're talking about something that is valuable. And they don't say, I don't answer a cell phone. Unless I'm in my vehicle, I don't answer it. I don't walk nowhere with a cell phone. I've had one longer than any of y'all listening. That's never been my thing. Someone calls me, I hear the little ringer go off, I'll get to it. If it's that important, leave me a message. You will never see me answer anyone in a store or walk around everyone see that. Listen to what it says now. This is what you have women doing today. A woman that travels about habitually, she's calling this one, talking to that one, doing this, internet and that one, Facebook and that one. That's habitual. Talk to me, Yisrael. And chiefly for social purposes, to gossip, to know this, to know that. That's all right. You can shut it off, but that's already still the truth. You're gossiping, Jezebel. Especially for social purposes. at a drunken woman's cause great anger, she will not kasah, she will not cover her own shame. She loves social talk and running her mouth. And yet when she does wrong, she doesn't see what she does wrong. She will not cover her own shame. She doesn't give a damn. You don't want no woman like that, man. Woman, you don't want a silly, stupid man. You don't want a man that has not the good or the good, not sure about his loins. You want a strong man. I don't give a damn about physical strength that has no power in it at all. It's a man conscious, this man that loves you. He's not willing to back down. I don't care what everybody else is doing. I've got to stand. I don't care which way they go. I'm going this way. I don't care how they turn. I'm turning right to you. Care what they do. You stand. After you're done, I'll still stand. You want a man like that. Hell is not even worth 6'9", 6'5". He's stupid. He's simple. He's weak. He's weaker than a man that 5'8". That is right. So you got women today traveling on. They travel. That's all they do, travel. Talking and talking and talking and talking. I will. That's wickedness. You should mind your house. You should be quiet and be busy with your hands, daughter. Sewing. Hallelujah. Make me some clothes, woman. That's all you need to do. Don't worry about nothing, huh? Make me some clothes. Hallelujah. I speak this to the daughters because I don't want you to see you that way. And you must, you don't even conceal or cover your own shame. Verse 9, it says, the whoredom, the zanun of a woman may be known in her haughty, lustful look in her eyelids. You could tell when a woman is lustful, when she's around a man, the way she looks, the way she carries herself, she wants to prop her breasts up. She wants to make sure you see that. She wants to make sure you can see her ass, or forgive me, her hips and all of that. She wants to make sure. She wants to accent that. You might as well talk to me. She wants to make sure she thinks she's got big breasts, and she wants to make sure that her breasts, you know, and everyone compliment my breasts. And my hippies are so hippie, hippie, hippie. Until you begin to uncover your nakedness, then he'll see, man, that's, talk to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can tell him lust for eyelids. And he says to the man, he say, keep strict watch over a headstrong daughter. See, men haven't done that. We haven't kept strict watch over our daughters. Daddies, you laughed and played. You act silly as hell. He said, keep strict watch over a headstrong daughter. Least when she find Rahab or liberty, when she find a broad wide way, she use it to her own hurt. She's not hurting you, but she's going to hurt herself. So you keep strict watch over. You don't let her just do her little thing. You don't do that. Be on guard against an impotent, against her impotent eyes, and do not wonder if she sinned against you. It's almost like the young man without wisdom. It tells us in the book of Mishlei 7 that the harlot, she sits and she waits, and she caught him with her eyes and say, come on and give me a kiss. That's what women look for. They look for someone they think is simple. Say, come on, just hug me. Can I just get close? Well, you don't know. Well, I love you. No, heifer, you don't love, because if you did that, you will not even confront like that. Your love will manifest itself in due time if you're a wife. And if you're the gem that you think you are, then Yah will grant you unto a man that fears him. If you love Yah the way you say you do, if you got this great love for Yah, he will grant a gem like you unto a man that fear him. And if you're just a damn phony hypocrite, then he's going to give you a hypocrite. Just like the last one that left from here that got married, I believe that Yah sent her that man. She doesn't have to argue with me. I know he did. He gave her just what she was. So if this woman got the beauty that she believes she has, you don't even have to worry about getting married. You don't have to worry about finding a husband, because Yah will grant you to a man that fears him. You don't even have to contemplate that or look for a man. He will grant you that. What about this? Are we going to get a husband? No, let her get right. Yah will grant her a man. We grant a man that fears him or love. I don't care if it's for 2 years. He will show you a love that you will never experience. There are women that have been married 2, 3, 5, 10 years. They have not experienced love. Heartache and aches and agonies and hardship. That's it. They don't know what love is. I know it's simple, but it's still right. We need this. Hallelujah. We fall away too much. We got to get back to the simple things. Verse 12. I got a few more scriptures. Bear with me. As a thirsty wayfarer opened his mouth and drink from any water near him. That's what a wayfarer man does. I don't care where the water is. He drinks. He's traveling. That's what a woman that loves to travel from house to house. She drinks from any well. She would talk to any man. Okay, give me her number. I'll call her. How you doing? You don't know me. This is Raphael. I'm Jean. How you doing? But I want to just talk to you a little bit. She's a nosy, busybody. She's annoying. She's in everybody's business. Hallelujah. Worst thing that y'all ever granted to this nation, these damn thing they call cell phones and thing. It's destroying more families than anything. And that internet thing, that's what it is. And that's just a fact. Imagine we just had that here, we just utilize it anyways. We would be in a mess here. You'd be doing some of the most wickedest things. You'd be surprised some of the things. I've never said to you that what Sam was doing here on the internet. You'd be surprised if I told you. Did you say a lie? You will be surprised. The ones that you think will not do it are the ones that do it. You will be surprised if I told you. I just haven't told you. So as a thirsty wayfarer opens his mouth and drinks from any water near him, so will she sit. That's what this kind of evil one will do. In front of every post and open her quiver to the arrow. She opened her mouth. She opened her heart to every kind of wicked thing. She knows everything. She knows as hell. She's a busybody. She's talking. She's in every kind of affair. Talk to me, Yisrael. That's not a beautiful wife. You don't want nothing like that. She's going to bring some of the most unclean things into your home. She's going to bring some of the most filthiest spirits. You don't want no wife like that. I don't care who you are. If you're offended by this, that's the kind of wife you are. My friends, it says a wise virtue, a wise purity, it makes her husband's heart fat. It delights him. He likes to see her. Just even seeing her. He doesn't have to, just let me see. I just won't look at you. It delights his quiver. It makes a man's heart happy. Come on, wife. A wife now. It delights a husband. It makes him happy. It makes him strong. It adds, it makes his heart pumps better and faster and fat. Makes him fat. And her discretion, her taboon, her understanding, her knowledge, her skillful ways, her intelligent, and her skills put fats on his bone. When you have a wife that talks or betrothed to one that talks wise, and she talks like an understanding woman, it makes the man fat. It put fatness on his bones. That's what I want. I want fatness on my bone because it takes that to live. That's why I take calcium in my bones to keep them strong. I take calcium every day, except Yom Shabbat. I take calcium for my bone. And it's a difference. So that's what a wife does. She makes the man's bones fat. She makes him strong. She brings life to him. What a blessing. Only that can come from a wife. It can't come from drugs. It comes from a wife. Can't come from the health food store. It comes from a wife. It tells us in verse 14, it uses the word a chason, a silent a chason. Sharak 12:14, a silent a wife that, I want to read the definitive of chason. I copied this, all right? A chason is one that she holds her tongue, her peace. She doesn't talk much. She holds her tongue and she just stands still. That's what a hason, a silent. It doesn't mean she doesn't talk, but she's a hason. A silent wife is a gift of Yah. Man, that's a gift. That's a gemuel from Yah. She holds her tongue. She holds her spirit. She's quiet. She sits still. As I tell you the stories how old mama would sit at the table with papa and she would just be quiet. She didn't say anything. Mr. Mother, yes. That's how she would say, yes, sir. She'd just sit there and watch him. And when he was ready to talk, he would talk. And she would talk. She didn't go there. Well, how was your day? Well, you pulled that mule out of the Didst down there heard that? No, she was just quiet. His bones agony, he was agonizing in the pain, the thoughts of his sons and his daughters, the hardship. And she understood that she would just sit at the table. She would make his meal, get him a little water. She says, "User wants some more bread." "Yes, I'm just using me some bread." "Yes, I'm." And she would do that. She would just sit there and quiet. See, he didn't know how to look at her. He didn't know how to hold his eyes up to look at her. But it was just that Hassan that gave strength to that man. He could get her every day. And she had a bit of brutal, nagging, contemporary, antagonizing woman. It would have killed the man. And that's why there were old men that stayed with their wives until they died. Even they had strength to get up and work every day. That's a wife like that. She's a gift from Yah. And there is nothing. You hear that, daughter? He said, "Well, the enemy has robbed from you. There's nothing so yacha, so precious, so prized, so much value of such beauty, more precious as a disciplined nephesh or a wife that is disciplined. She knows when to talk, when to shut up, when to be quiet, when to caress, when to input. She knows when to. But a foolish woman doesn't know how to do that. There's nothing more precious. Your price is far above great rubies. You just the enemy just rob you and rape you like a dirty whore. And we too damn ignorant to hear someone to show us how to shape up and get in shape for Yah. It tells us a modest, shame-faced and faithful wife. See, you don't want to be a woman that you want to draw the attention of the other ark or other men. You want to walk in a way that no other man is looking at you. You want to serenade a bishop would tell us mints and everybody, you think you got a buttocks that is attractive. It stinks. I'm not going to stop talking like that. What comes out of yours comes out of everyone else's. Dung. You're stupid. But a shame faced it. And a faithful wife. As virtue to virtue, she becomes more pure. Every day you see, she's so beautiful. That when you see, you want to drop your head. Not that you just look at her and say, "I despise that thing." The women I look at, I despise them. I say this. I don't like them. I don't. And women I don't like, I don't like them. I hate a silly, stupid woman. I hate that. Because y'all didn't make the daughters that way. That's worldliness and that's world in them. And they think they can get by with that because they've got by in the world. You don't get by with that jive with me. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're Michelle Obama. I don't care if you got a Harvard degrees. I don't care if you're cum laude. See, that's what a beautiful wife does. She adds purity to purity. And her contented mind and her chaste nephesh cannot be valued. When you find a woman that's chaste and beautiful, her beauty cannot even be valued. You tell me, Yah, you made the riches of the heaven. You tell me that a simple thing like a woman like that cannot be valued. You don't hear that? Can you place a value on the sun or the moon? And Yah said a woman like that, she can't even be valued. You said the enemy rob your daughter. See, she has such value that is beyond. Yah said there's no price you can put to that. He said, tell me what she's worth. You can't buy this. You can't buy a wife like that. He said that her value is so great, but she has such great beauty and value. There ain't no value like that. And the enemy robs you and rapes us. What the assembly, the value of the assembly to Yah? There's nothing more valuable in all his creation like the assembly. Nothing. Hallelujah. She must be shamefaced. Like the sun rising in the height of Yah, so is the beauty of a tough wife in her well-ordered home. Not only in a physical home, but in a spiritual home, it is well ordered. Everything is set in place. Her mind is where it should be. Her heart, her will, her desire, her passion, everything is placed in its proper order. And her beauty is seen by others. That's why a virtuous woman, her husband is known in the marketplace. When she comes into the market, that men, they admire her because they speak well of her to her husband. Like the shining lamp of a Kodesh candlestick. So is the beauty of a face in the ripe age. Like pillars. Now, this is the beauty of a precious wife. Look, it says like pillars of gold on a house on the base of silver. So are the beautiful feet with a steadfast, or all men, steadfast have left. As golden pillars are upon the sockets of silver, so are the fair feet with a constant lamp. My son, keep the flower of your age sound, and give not your strength to strangers or women of no strength. Don't give your strength unto a woman, nor your ways unto one that destroys. The king is what Shlomo said to him. Verse 20 of Shirach 26. When you have gotten a fruitful, that's what she is. She is a para. She is a fruitful possession through all the fields. Sow it with your own seed. Trust in the tub of your stock. So when you find a wife, that is a wife, you find a fruitful possession, then he says you bring forth seeds. You sow into that wife, that you will bring forth tough seeds, because they will have the same spiritual genetics as you possess. So your race which you leave shall be magnified, having the confidence of their tough descent. He says a harlot shall be accounted as spittle. When a woman is wicked of harlotry, she's not even worth the value of spit. When she goes serenading herself in her own desire, her own will, she is of the value of spittle. But a married woman, is a tower against death to her husband. You see what he has put in a wife? Why would you not want to be that? A married woman, a woman that is bala, she is a tower of strength against death unto her husband. She brings life. And the enemy used your daughters to bring death. You are the purpose of bringing life, strength, and beauty. A wicked woman is given as a portion to a wicked man. That's who she's given to. But a woman that loves Yah, she's given to a man that fears Yah. But a wicked woman is given to a wicked man. But a virtuous woman is given to him that fears Yah. A woman of strength and beauty, a woman that loves Yah, she's given to a man that fears Yah. A dishonest woman contends. This is what a dishonest woman does. She always contends. She always ma'as. She always rejects. She despises. She always disputes. She contends shame. Even though you show how wrong she is, she says, it's not me. I'm better than that. She contends shame. She doesn't even identify her shame. She doesn't even want to see herself. That's what she does. But an honest woman will be revered, or will reverence her husband. An honest woman that fears Yah, she will honor her husband. There are women that their husbands weren't saved, but they didn't go outside of the proximity of that marriage and do things that were crazy to try to defy their husband. There was a woman that was with us, and she said to me, I did everything you said. I said, lies. You did what I told you to do to your husband. You would not be in the condition you're in. Don't tell me you did what I told you. Because I've told too many to do what I told them they did, and I have the testimonies of the change in their home. You didn't do what I told you. You were loquacious. You talked too damn much. You ran your mouth. You want to dispute. You had an answer for everything, and now you're lonely and by yourself, and you're going to stay that way. You're wicked. So he'll give you a wicked man. But a woman that reverence Yah, he will give her a man that fears Yah. It says, a shameless woman. A woman that thinks she has everything, she is shameless. It says she will be counted. She shall be counted as a dog. So you see why they call them dogs today? A woman that has no shame, she will be counted as a dog. That's what it says. You want to be shamefaced, daughters. You don't want to make yourself seen. You don't want to make yourself known. You want to be shamefaced. You want to be quiet. But a shameless woman, she shall be counted as a dog. But she that is shamefaced, shamefaced, will fear Yah. A woman that honors her husband shall be judged wise of all. When a man sees a woman that honors her husband, she will be judged as a wise woman. When she honors her husband, should we not honor Yah? When she honor her husband, she will be found to be a wise woman of all. But she that dishonor him in her gaon shall be counted virtueless of all. What does that gaon mean? That gaon, in her pride. She's an arrogant beast. Well, you can't tell her nothing. Come on, I would think that a woman that's been married 25, 30, 40 years, and their husband is happy and contented, that she should be able to tell you something, daughters. Hallelujah. But if you're arrogant, you have the gaon, you're not going to listen to anyone. You're not going to hear anyone because you're arrogant, you're full of pride, you think you know everything. If you know everything, you wouldn't be in the condition you were in. I will. You will not be in the shape you're in. Hallelujah. So a woman that fears Yah, she will be found as a jewel unto a man that seeks Yah for a wife. And she will be given unto a man like that. He says this in my closing. Two verses I want to close with. Yah says in Sirach 26, 27, a loud crying woman. You hear her. You can hear her talk. She's always running her mouth. A loud crying woman. And a skull shall be sought out to drive away the enemy. So if you want to drive away your enemies, get you a loud woman and let her run her mouth. Why? Because this is her character here. Shaul Shlomo says this in Mishli. I close here. 9:13. It says a kes el uth, or a foolish, stupid, silly woman. She is chama, she is clamorous. She is stupid, she is silly. What is a clamorous woman? I read the definitive. What chama means? She murmurs, she growls, she roars, she cries aloud. She's always in a rage, she makes noise, she's in tumult, she's disquieted, she's always troubled, she's always in an uproar, she always got to tell you her mind, she always got to speak, she always got to talk, she always got input. That's what that kind of woman is. She is a foolish woman. She is always clamorous. You have a woman always got this. She's got to get it right. She's going to be the one to set it in order. You're dealing with a foolish woman. And that's what we are. We're going to get it right. We can't get it right. Y'all must get it right. You understand? Yeah. A foolish woman, she is clamorous. She is loud. She is clamorous. She is simple. She's a silly damn thing. She is easily seductible. And she's always trying to seduce. That's what that word means. That's what Peth Aluth means. She's a silly woman. She's always trying to be seductive. And she doesn't know a damn thing. She knows nothing. She yada, nothing at all. That's what a foolish woman is. She thinks she knows, but she doesn't know Yisraya. She thinks she got a plethora of knowledge and wisdom, but she doesn't understand one thing at all. So when you find a woman like that, you run from that. Don't even touch her. Don't even let her touch you. Don't even let her give you a gift to destroy your judgment. Don't let her do that. Don't let the woman do that. I never forget, as a young man, I'll never forget. I was going to join the military again, and I went to the military place. I was about 100, I was 200 pounds then. And they told me, you got to get down to 185 pounds before we take you. I was fit as a fiddle, muscular, strong. And I'll never forget, I was young, I was ignorant, didn't know the ways of Yah, and still don't. That's why I traverse in the simple principles that he opened up unto me. And I went down to the military station. And there was when I was a 10th grader, there was a girl in my school. Her name was Angela Clinton. She was in the 12th grade. She had a sister. And Angela Clinton, she was this very fair-skinned woman. Everybody thought she was just finer than ice, you understand? But and every day I would go to school, she would always say to me, David, just let me kiss your eyes. Of course, my eyes are not old like they are now. She would always kiss my eyes every day. She would always do that. And so when I went down to the station, I hadn't seen her in many years. I had gone in the military, gotten out. And then when I saw her, she's, oh, my. She was not, come on, she was married at that time. I was married. It was nothing even that in school with her. She was just an older girl in school. I was a sophomore. She was a senior. And I never forget, there was this woman, she walks out of the office. She said, who is this? And as far as the world concerned, she was fine. Look at thing now. That's the truth. And I said to Angie, once the woman said that I knew, I said, I don't like this right here. I was young. I hadn't been married for about a year. She said, I'll take you home with me and cook your steak. I said, nah. She said, I was just kidding. I didn't see what you would say. And she was an older woman. She was probably about 30, 32 at that time. And so I said, nah. I said, I can't do that. She said, I was just kidding. I was just playing with you. She said, but if you're hungry, I'll take you home with me. If I tell you what, I can cook too. I said, nah, we can't go that way. So I really wanted to get out of there. When I got out of that place, and Yah is my witness, I didn't even know this. Ketveh said that, to flee from you for lust. I just hauled off. I had caught the bus that day. We didn't have one vehicle. And I just ran from all the way down there by CP. You know that's a straight hill up there going back in those days on Trade Street. I ran all the way to the square. I got away from there and never went back. You understand? I didn't go back to see if she was there. Hallelujah. I didn't go back to see if I could find her either. So what? That's what we must do. We must flee the foolishness of our ways, run from that, and run toward Yah. That's what you do, all right? Yah barak you, all you that were blessed, that's all right. And you that were not blessed, that's all right too. And you that Yah corrected, that's a beautiful thing. And you that he spanked your dirty butt, wonderful. Hallelujah. And you that need to pull it up, pull it up. Hallelujah. That's what you need to do. And what you need to do is do introspective research on your own heart. There's nothing more beautiful and more precious of a gem and a valuable weight than an Ishah. Nothing, daughters. There's nothing more prized by man and by Yah than a wife. Sex is not the prize thing because a man can get sex. He wants a wife. He wants a wife. He can get sex all day. He wants a wife. If I'm looking for sex, I get it all day. He wants a wife. You understand? He wants a wife. And there's nothing but prize of a gem upon the face of nothing in Yah's creation. And the gem of a wife, she's a beautiful thing. That's why the enemy denigrates her and brings her down to nothing but a damn piece of filthy flesh, a sex bag as a dog. And she has no shame. You men, you run. You don't even get close to a silly woman. Stay away from them. You don't listen. Don't do that. Run and save yourself from that wickedness. When a woman is right, everyone will see she's right. She's beautiful. Men will see that. Strangers will see it. I don't care where you go, they will see it. Hallelujah. And you daughters out there that are listening, you that are here, quit talking on them damn selves. And don't, if someone calls you out there, just wait and get to a place of privacy and then call, okay? Them crazy things up on your head like that, you're going to have cancer and everything. That's why your brains are messed up. That's the truth. That's the truth, Yisrael. You see these silly women, everywhere you go, they got them. They just talking about it. I hate to get in line when they're doing that. I get antsy when they do. I get angry. I just look. Because they turn around looking. Well, girl, okay, I'm in line at the store. I'll call you back. Silly woman. Stupid thing. That's stupid. Cheap cell phone. People, you look at people out there, they think that's something. They're crazy. They're so crazy. Sometimes Arcane, yes, I call him. I say, you know how I am. I turn that thing. I got your call. I turn that thing on Thursday. I don't turn that thing on. What? I use it when I go out. That's it. I don't talk when I get no calls. You call me. I'm sorry, Ark. That's okay. Because when I got it, it was on that Thursday. I said, oh, man. I tell Zakane Yeshua, I say, look, I can't get on you because when I call you, you left the cell phone at home. You never take it with you. I said, I can't get on you because I don't turn that thing on to Thursday. If I leave out, that's the only time I turn it on. If I don't leave out, I don't turn it on. You understand? And so when someone calls me, I say, ask who it is. I have no problem with y'all asking who it is. I'm not that way. I don't have to hide nothing. So you could ask. Who's calling? Listen, you daughters. Anytime someone calls here, you say, may I take a message? Oh, I don't care who it is. You don't have to send some secretive. He got a call. Now, just tell me, who is it? Okay, tell them, take a message from him. Tell them to call me back. I'll call him back later. I'm too far away. I'm not walking back there. That's just the way I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I don't even use that thing because I'm not going to let it fry my ears out. That's the truth. May Yah barak you. You that have joined us, may the riches of Yah rest upon you all. All right. Let us turn toward Yerushalayim. In all things, we debarak you, Omari Yah. We told you for Yeshua HaMashiach, bless your people, go with them, strengthen us all. We pray for Ima Yunus and all of your people scattered abroad, the states, the world, wherever they are. Touch them all, I pray, in Yeshua's name, and give us guidance, those that join us, our friends, and even our enemies. We told you for all things in Yeshua's name. Hallelujah. 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 Yabarak. Shalom.